At 7:50, we'll have our first hearing of the evening on the Town Forest Committee revised rules and regulations. A second hearing at 8:15 regarding an order of taking for water easements on Belmont Street. We'll close the warrant for the subsequent town meeting at 8:30, as well as close the warrant for the November election. So we've got a full evening as far as legislative events. We'll have a third hearing regarding a request for early opening for Cumberland Farms on Salem Street, and make an amendment to the Board of Selectmen policy as it relates to licensing authority to include the role of deputy chief. We'll discuss the award of bond anticipation notes as it relates to West Street, and approve a change of name for the wine shop in Reading. We'll close the evening out by talking about town manager fiscal 15 goals and formalizing the town manager evaluation for the past year. With that, I will turn to my colleagues and collect liaison reports. Marcy.
I did not have a chance to attend the RMLD commissioners meeting, but I did have an opportunity to watch it on TV. I would encourage everyone on the Board of Selectmen to take a look at that and watch that.
What's the date, Marcy?
It was last Wednesday. Mm-hmm. Bill's nodding his head, so I assume that he knows.
17. Yep.
And there is a link to be able to see that on YouTube very easily. So I did want to point that out. There was quite a bit of discussion about Articles 14 and 15. There was a lot of discussion about the whole situation with the truck disposition. There's also discussion and voting on the procedures, the new procurement procedures. And so I just wanted to comment on the fact that there was some discussion around the whole truck disposition, that some of the way that it was discussed perhaps didn't reflect the full picture of the timing and actually the when certain things happen. So there was discussion in that session about the fact that, well, the trucks are all back now, that, you know, everything was fine, they're doing the new policy. Really, the way that it appeared in terms of the timing and the research that was done was that the research that the town accountant did really pushed this to the point where the research was eventually done to say that the whole sale was not legal. That was not the case at first. At first, it was all fine. At first, all of the discussion was that the procedures were followed. Although when you look at it from an intellectual, just kind of logical standpoint, it doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. The only other thing I wanted to comment on is I know that the policies at RMLD are all quite old, and we knew that actually when I was there for a year. I actually did work on changing one of the policies there. I specifically ran to change the policy that had been implemented around renewable energy certificates and making that change so that we were able to sell those. That change did go into effect. There were changes that were taken, actually made around some of the subcommittees. So those changes were made as well. After I left the board after a year, some of those things reverted back. I'm not really sure why there was no further work done on the policies. I know they knew that they were out of date. So that's all I wanted to say on that.
And just so it's tied to that, I also took a look at the same video that Marcy's referring to. And a couple of, for those watching on television or later by video, as many of you know, there are two articles on the September 29th warrant as they relate to the subject of FinCom authorities to inquire into town body financial events. As the Board of Selectmen have been told, the charter does not permit FinCom to make inquiries of RMLD, and it is the Board of Selectmen's desire that the procurement processes of the town, of the schools, and of RMLD as an organ of the town, if you will, that we look generally at procurement in general with as an area that we might improve upon, or to see just how well we are operating and what common and disparate practices are in place. So Article 14 puts in place the language under our current charter that allows FinCom to engage formally on the question of inquiring of RMLD. FinCom already has that authority under the charter with regard to the town and the school. So if you will, 14 provides that level base so that FinCom can operate in a common manner. Article 15 corrects the deficiency or the language that makes a distinction between the town and the schools versus RMLD so that there is no need to make a distinction going forward. Last night in the same video, there was a fair amount of, I think, confusion over the motivation of those articles, and they're purely to look at the efficiency and the consistency of procurement practices across the town. I think the concern might have come about by virtue of the construction of one of the articles, which names RMLD specifically, but as I said moments ago, that's because of the unique structure of the current charter. With that, I'll turn to Kevin. Any comments for this evening?
Yeah, actually, myself and John Halsey attended an MAPC update, today in regards to a project goals that they're hoping to have finalized by June of 2015. So what they're looking at right now is market analysis on some of our supportable development areas that we have. They've identified four top areas that we have around town, the 40-yard downtown, One General Way, the South Main Street, and the area behind the RMLD as areas that have good potential to be developed. And so they're going to look at over the next 8 months and come up with a market analysis for those particular areas as far as what the best use would be. Would they recommend any further development there, whether it's mixed use, straight residential? They're going to look at the retail side of it, the industrial side of all those areas. They really try to help the town come up with some development for those sites in particular. So they had some pretty interesting information that they were giving us, and as well as part of that, they're going to be looking for some help from folks in and around town, for example, brokers, mixed use landlords of large projects, mm-hmm. Just to try to help them develop a market analysis of these, in particular these four areas. They're going to look at some other ones as well, but these four areas in particular is what they're going to be spending some time looking at. So they're going to have two public meetings. Sounds like they're going to be right around the springtime, 2015. They're looking to have a final plan and evaluation ready for us to look at by June of 2015.
Fascinating.
That's it.
Dan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On September 8th, I attended the meeting of the Historical Commission. During that meeting, Criterion presented a revised plan for 186 Summer Avenue. I don't know if the public in general is aware of that. The revised plan does not involve the demolition of the house, rather just interior renovations and the addition of a second building of about the same massing behind it and staggered such that it's not terribly visible from the street. Plan also retains the carriage house, which will be renovated in the second phase for storage. I did send that information to both newspapers. Heretofore, they haven't chosen to print it yet, so there was no press coverage at that particular meeting. I believe that's the plan that will be submitted for limited site plan review. So that I think the neighbors should take a lot of credit for forcing this change in design. It certainly strikes me, if it goes forward, as being a much friendlier use of that property, although I think there are a lot of hurdles certainly to go yet. On the 10th, I attended the Financial Forum. One takeaway I have is that we spent a lot of time talking about how we need to kind of tax our way into prosperity internally by taxing the people of this town. I want this board to send a very strongly worded letter to our representatives and state senator urging full restoration of the lottery aid that has been cut from cities and towns over the last few years. I think we need to beat that drum as loud, if not louder, than any interior revenue enhancing plans that we have. That was my takeaway from that. Last night, at John Halsey's request, I attended the school committee meeting in his place. There was a lot of RACASA discussion going on. Under open comment, I expressed the board's concern about the loss of the seventh grade substance abuse position and asked if that money were being repositioned in the budget for similar use. Superintendent Doherty did say that there was a counselor put on at the high school level and that, to deal with more severe substance abuse situations, and they deemed that to be a better use short term of the money. But there are three very good pieces of news that came out of the RACASA presentation. Number one, there are three grants that the town of Reading has received. One is a drug, and this was known before the meeting, a drug-free community grant. That's $125,000 for 5 years. Erica McNamara and Julianne DeAngelis are handling that. That has to do with the surveys that are being done of student behavior, mm-hmm. and the direction of appropriate remediation on that basis. The two new grants that were announced, the first was a two-year, $50,000 per year grant for the psychological safety needs of students. And this is the exciting one, a five-year, $250K per year. And that literally came in minutes before the school committee adjourned. Wow. Five-year, $250,000 per year grant to implement the MTSS, which is the multi-tiered system of support. It's basically, it's a sort of a triage is a strong word. They want to deal with students that are doing fine, give them the support they need. If there are students moderately at risk, either academically or because of behavioral issues, there are teams that will be assembled from interns and paid professionals to provide the support to the schools that are needed. And for those students greatly at risk, the Tier 3, more intervention will be tried. And it sounds like a very creative way. I have to give my kudos to Sarah Burdar, who gave that presentation. She's the Reading School Support Services for Behavioral Health Professional, and I think we're in good hands there. So I think this funding, the external funding, will compensate quite a bit for what was lost in the middle schools. Not completely, perhaps, and in somewhat different ways, but the problem is being addressed, and I think all concerned express their interest.
Certainly more resources.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm done.
Thank you, Dave. John?
I've got actually a quick run through of a lot of different topics. One, I'd like to thank Dan for pinch hitting for me last night. This report he just gave you regarding RACASA's presence before the school committee, I think, is very exciting. I mean, they're doing good work. It's not enough yet. They know that. We in Reading, through RACASA, have taken a leadership role, which I think is really important, and much work to do. And we're starting to get some resources that are acknowledging the work that's been done already. Just a couple of other quick things on RACASA. One is that on October 1st at 7:00 in the Performing Arts Center, the annual meeting, open to the public. You know, I think it's I would urge everybody in this room to come and hear what's going on, and everybody, you know, in TV land as well that can come down. I think it'll be an important meeting given the report that Dan has just given regarding them. Furthermore, there will be a reconnection of the World Cafe that happened several years ago. That's going to be happening on October 23rd at 7:00, and that's going to be held in the field house. Only difference this year is that, you know, we've been able to make a lot of progress since the last one, which has now been 4 or 5 years. And secondarily, it's going to be open on a little more regional basis. As I've mentioned, RACASA is taking a leadership role, and other surrounding communities are interested in, you know, partaking. So I think that's all good. The reason I couldn't attend that presentation is I was at the, on Monday night, I was at the Board of Health, hosted a kickoff meeting for a strategic planning session. For a strategic planning process, actually, and it was an introductory session. And the Board of Health, along with the staff director, Ruth Clay, had invited many guests who came. Hallmark, Sanborn, of course, police and fire were present, elder services. And Wally Arshinoff from Harrow's, you know, was there to kind of represent the restaurant community a little bit. So it was a great collection of people. It was facilitated, and the movement last night was the try to understand where we are and, you know, set the stage for where we're going. And, you know, there's going to be a lot more that'll come out of that, but there was a thought that, you know, bringing partners, you know, into this, you know, private and public partnerships, I think, are going to be a theme that we're going to be looking towards, and there was a lot of that going on. There's not a lot of substance to report because there was a lot of projects going on and developing information, which will be fed back to us, and I'll bring that back to you at a later date. I do want to take just a few minutes, and I know we have a pretty full schedule, but I had an extended visit with the Recreation Committee. There is so much good news going on there, and they're such a proactive, that committee and the department that's supervised by John Feudo and Jenna as his assistant are just doing great things. They had a presentation, again, back to the partnership of public and private. If you look at the Birch Meadow plan, it calls for dugouts down at Morton Field. And so there was some discussion about replacing the benches because the benches are shot and, you know, maybe not in exactly the right spot from a safety standpoint. And so all that being said, there was an outreach a few months ago to users. And Reading Babe Ruth is the primary user besides this high school there. And they put their heads together and came back with a proposal and said, hey, we know the dugouts are on the plan. You know, why don't you let us do them now and, you know, make a gift, which I thought was a great thing for them to step forward and do. They've got some money in place already to put down the pad and the sleeves for the dugouts and so forth. And they're going to actually appear in front of us because the Recreation Committee forwarded them on to us for these dugouts. And we'll hear more about that at a special meeting. But again, another nice example of the Recreation Department seems to have figured out way ahead of the rest of us how these partnerships are going to work. Another thing that they did with a local firm, Sentinel Benefits, they came out kind of with their whole company and cleaned up that and painted that whole wall mm-hmm. behind the tennis courts, you know, and straightened that all up. I mean, they did a day of service is really what they did. It was less about money and more about the work and
public service.
And getting the partnership together. On the topic of tennis, the Recreation Department and committee have found a way to partner with some software providers who will create, in addition to our Premier Pass program, reserve a game. So you're going to be able to, you have a Premier Pass, you're going to be able to reserve a game online, and you'll pay $5 or $10 for that. I forget what the number is exactly. And of course, the software company has said that the town should keep that. So again, another, you know, an already good program down at the tennis courts that's going to be enhanced even that much more. They also worked on a policy, kind of to your point, Marcy, about updating policies. One of the things that the committee, along with John Feudo, discovered is that there was a little glitch in the policy of the people that are brought in to run the baseball camp or the, you know, the various camps that get run mm-hmm. often are people who are currently town employees here or town employees someplace else.
Makes sense.
And because they're coaches and educators and so forth, so it always has made sense and continues to make sense. But there's a little glitch in the law that says there may be a conflict of interest if you don't declare that, create an independent contractor relationship, which is all now in motion. And so it's not going to change who does them. It's going to change how they're documented and how the relationship goes forward. And, you know, so I think it's good that they're looking at their policies and updating those that need to be updated. Big news, I think probably, I didn't get a chance to get by there today, but I think the lights on Memorial Park are either up or going up this week.
I don't know if they're on, but they're up.
Well, yeah, and what I was told was they would probably be up this week, but on October 1st. And so I think the big message is that those are going to be ready to go by the time there's ice skating down there. And, you know, I think that's a real positive. Along with that, there's a flag going up with a ground light at Memorial Park as well. So
that's fantastic.
Lots of great stuff happening there. And, you know, I think it's important in this theme I'm trying to get across is that, again, all of that work down at recent work, the most current work at Memorial Park is, you know, there are private parties involved in helping that happen. I know Nelson Burbank was very actively involved in that. RMLD was involved, the Army Corps of Engineers, the DPW, the Recreation Committee, engineering. I mean, it's kind of nice when everybody works together and nobody gets in the way. And it just kind of, you know, you get a really nice project done without any, and you do it kind of inside the cash flow management that you have, and, you know, you don't have to do anything special and you don't have to chase a lot of money, and it kind of all comes together. So that's happening down there. Another project that was just completed, I would urge people to drive by because it's gorgeous, is the, at Birch Meadow, a new rock wall has been put in, you know, for the kids to play on, and it's really, again, you know, everybody kind of pitching in, and it's a beautiful, beautifully completed little project for the kids to be able to be involved on. On the topic of projects, Washington Park is underway with a completion date expected on October 15th, and that's going to be a new tennis court. It's going to, you know, there's going to be, you know, I think there's a basketball court. I don't have I'm going to let them come in and give you all the details of that, but that's going to be a finished, that phase will be finished, everything but the baseball field, really, by mid-October. We had been involved in kind of being a good neighbor and having John Feudo assist Wakefield in the absence of a recreation director while they were figuring out what they were going to do, and they've decided to hire a recreation director because I think they figured out when you have somebody like John Feudo
paying attention,
lots of stuff happens, and so they've actually hired a former employee of the Reading Recreation Department to be their recreation director. So that's happened, and so John's off, not that he was ever on their clock, but we were being a good neighbor there, and he's off of that. You know, I could go on and on here, and I'm not. There's going to be a downtown trick or treat and a Halloween parade that's going to be happening with businesses that want to participate. That's going to be happening the Wednesday before Halloween. I think that's an awesome thing that's going to be going on for the kids. There is flag football. I think we talked about this in our last meeting.
Absolutely,
we agreed to, you know, let them expand some of the lighting down at Birch Meadow. 600 kids, 551 kids are involved in that every Saturday night, and that's such a good place for them to be. It's their young kids, and the families are very involved, and it's very festive. It's kind of a great night, and it kind of spreads, you know, all along, you know, the Birch Meadow field, and there's a lot going on there, including, I would say, a girls-only division. So there are, you know, there are enough girls to be able to put two flag football teams out there for the girls that want to participate in the girls-only division. So that seems to be a booming partnership as well with the people that are putting on, you know, Saturday Night Lights. So Fall Street Fair was a big success, and obviously the Recreation Department was a big driver along with the committee, the volunteers, 176 vendors, 25 stage performances. You know, the entertainment vendors that put up the blow-up stuff that the kids get to play in drove $3,500 back, you know, which was, you know, a big plus, and all those financials flow back to the town. So that's a lot, but they're doing a lot, and I think it's important for all of us here to be really aware of it, and for the public at large to be aware of the Recreation Department, the great work they're doing.
Thank you, Jim. You know, you touched on this public-private partnership as being the foundation for a lot of these improvements and activities, and I couldn't agree with you more. That's going to become more and more the vehicle by which these sorts of improvements around the edge, not the core activities that we do in town government, but certainly around recreation with the number of parents and the number of kids and the amount of interest in sports and recreation activities, that's going to continue to be, as big as it is today, I think it'll continue to grow.
I think so too. And I, you know, to echo Dan's statement about the financial forum, which I also attended, there seemed to be a real drive towards taxation as an only solution, and I happen to disagree with that. It may be a solution, but you know, this whole idea of creating opportunities for revenue that happen either internally as part of the town government or in partnership, I mean, these are ways that real revenue comes on. I mean, when you look at the recreation department, for example, they're pretty self-sustaining, you know, when it comes to that, with the way they partner up and the way that they're able
Absolutely.
To. And people are very comfortable with the fees that are being charged for the activities. They're fair and reasonable and affordable, and you know, even in the partnerships, there is a steady flow of revenue, you know, which comes back.
Carl McFadden talked about the number of children enrolled, and I think it was 300-ish, 400-ish, 500-ish, and now cresting 600.
Yeah.
You know, that's a heck of a year-over-year growth.
I think they've doubled every year is really what's happened. I think they started with about 100, 150 kids.
Unbelievable. Thank you, John. Public comment. Is there anyone who would like to make a public comment? Mr. Salter.
Yes, hi. Bob Salter, 247 Summer Avenue. And I totally agree with you, Mr. Halsey, about the public-private relationship. And I want to say how proud I am of my wife, who has worked for many years bringing such things into town. But that's not why I came to speak to you today. I came to speak because about 6 weeks ago I spoke to you, in which I expressed concern about the company Criterion inserting their business into our Summer Avenue residential neighborhood. And their lawyers claim to be able to do this by circumventing our zoning bylaws was particularly concerning. I want to give you an update on what the neighborhood and surrounding community has done since that date. We have collected over 650 signatures from town citizens asking Criterion to reconsider a more appropriate site in Reading. We have 250 signs on front lawns identifying households who are concerned, and there are another 250 getting placed this week. The interesting thing is that these Reading residents that are speaking out are not just in the surrounding neighborhood, but they're throughout our town, indicating an overall community concern. This is because the neighborhood Criterion are proposing to insert themselves to is one of Reading's signature defining neighborhoods. Since our community has collectively started to voice our concerns, Criterion, as Mr. Ensminger put forth what I would call a non-binding proposal, preserving aspects of the historical home. And while you may think that might satisfy us, it does very little to address the overwhelming objection that a 10,000 square foot business with now 40 parking spaces is inserting themselves into our neighborhood with no neighborhood feedback, traffic impact, and not in regard to any business development plan that we've developed here in Reading. We believe that the Criterion proposal to move into 186 Summer Avenue is a bad deal for the neighborhood, having a negative impact on property values, negative traffic impact on Parker Middle School, and is a bad deal for Reading at large. We believe Criterion is a good business entity and should be encouraged to find a more appropriately business zone location in Reading, consistent with our Reading business development plans. We hope we have Selectmen support in representing this 650 Reading citizens and encourage Criterion to seek alternative locations. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, John. For those that might be interested, today is the 70th anniversary of the Rockets. And to follow up from Mr. Halsey said, the Corps of Engineers flew in people from all over the country. There's one from New Mexico, one from Arizona, one from New Jersey to come in and work on that project. So while it may have saved the running taxpayers money, it cost us all the taxpayers and the flagpole is not going to be in this year. I think they said it's going to be for next spring. And we need a new flagpole down there, so either an article in the warrant or a good generous donation, because the original, the one down there, I believe, is still the original one that was put up in 1918. So anybody out there who's listening would like to donate. And it's going to have to go further back because the tree warden won't allow us to cut the trees down to block the flag.
So those volunteers are coming from Alaska and Hawaii, right?
What's that? I don't know. They're the only reserve outfit in left the United States that does a line tech. Huh. They're all, most everyone in that unit was professional line workers by trade. And they did a hell of a job. They didn't leave there until about 10 minutes after 6, because I was there when one of the trucks went up. I spent most of my day down there watching. It was very enjoyable.
Do you know what the cost of the new flagpole was?
I don't know, only $20,000.
Thank you, Mr. Browning. Okay. Sir?
Hi, good evening. For the record, my name is Attorney Robert McCarthy, 39 Pine Ridge Road. And I'm here as in an official capacity as the Reading representative to the duly elected school committee representative to the Northeast Metropolitan Regional Vocational School. And I come before you tonight talking about John's theme of around partnership. We are also talking tonight about a potential partnership with the school. We are holding a lottery for labor, and it's pretty self-explanatory in the handout you have. And we invite you out to the town of Reading. There's 12 communities in the school district. And there'll be a lottery. The winning district will get up to $10,000 in retail value for free labor for any vehicles or any auto technology collision repair, anything, any type of vehicles that the town may have, maybe a car, small SUV. The repairs will be done with our students in conjunction with the staff. And all you have to do is, I just want to make sure that you guys are on board. Someone has to be a contact person at the local level. So I want to come to the selectmen and talk about this lottery for labor, see if you're on board. I think it's some way that $10,000 in labor is a pretty substantial amount of money. The way it would work is, there might be some body work that needs to be done on some vehicles, or maybe mufflers on some of the cars or whatever it is. You pay for the materials, and the students will do the labor up to $10,000 in free labor. So it's another way for partnership. We have many kids from Reading that go to the school. They're well served there. So perfect example, case in point, when Bob Silver was the police chief here, he came to me and said that when they built the new police station, he said that there was a flaw that we don't have a community resource desk. So that beautiful community resource desk in the middle of the lobby was built by the vocational school. And we had the computer-aided design children design the plan. We worked with the police department, and the wood carpentry shop built that, and it's very durable, stand there for years and years and years. So that's just one example of many things that, as my job as the school committee rep from Reading, I try to heighten the awareness of the school and try to do some partnership with the community. So this is just one way of, and I don't know if you guys are interested in this, or it's something you guys want to talk. We're going to draw the winner in our meeting in October, which will be October 9th. So this has to be in by October 5th, if you're interested. And if you win, you get $10,000 of free labor on any vehicle clearly we're not going to deal with a fire engine or anything.
Right. A ladder truck, you might take a look at.
But I mean, something within the student realm. I mean, there may be some DPW trucks or, you know, some inspection vehicles that need some body work or labor or auto technology work, you know. So
is this the first year you've done something of this sort?
Yes. Yeah, we brought this before the school committee. It was kind of a way to, because we don't like the fact, and I personally don't like the fact of being over in Wakefield and there's really no connection to the community. So I think it's an important way to let
sure.
the 12 member communities know that we're there to service you and help you. Another thing we did was one year we made all flower boxes for all the storefronts downtown. Stuff like that. We've done a lot of other small projects throughout the community. So, you know, there's always things that we can do to help. So that's one of my goals is being a Reddingite. I also want to make sure that you know that the school's there to help you. And if there's anything we can do, you can call me in my law office or call me at my home. It doesn't matter. And I'd be more than glad to try to assist you.
I certainly have no objections. Anytime somebody says there's an opportunity for something to help both parties, that's a real win-win, right? Administratively, it's probably logical to manage it through our town manager and I presume our public works or one of our service groups.
So there'll be 12 entries, Mr. McCarthy? Is that
there'll be 12 entries from Reading.
Yeah, we're each going to put one in, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, they're just, you know, whoever wins, he wins.
Good.
I mean, this could spur further. I mean, there's always, even if you don't win, there's also, I mean, they call me, and if there's something I can do to help, Bob's been very helpful. As you know, I don't know if he's talked to you about, we're in the process of trying to get a new building, or a renovation, a combination thereof. So we're dealing with the 12 communities. We have to get all unanimous decision, and Bob has been very, very helpful, helping us with the finances and looking at that. So we're going to have to deal with SBA, so that building's over almost 50 years old. So
it's one of the three worst school buildings in the state.
Mm-hmm. Probably, if it wasn't for the students, it would have fallen down a long time.
Exactly. Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
From everything I've heard about this.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, they really, there's no, we don't have a, you know, a slash fund that think of as a capital plan. I mean, if something happens, most of the teachers and students do all the work there, so. But anyways, I just wanted to give kudos to Bob. He's been extremely helpful. He comes to all our meetings when we have meetings over there. He's been very, very helpful to us. So I just wanted to say that we're here to help in any way we can. I think this is a good opportunity for see if we can work together.
Cool.
But if we don't win, if there's anything else that I can do to help you, please call upon.
Appreciate the offer, and thank you for coming out tonight and letting us know. Huh?
Just to follow up on some of Jack's comments, when I met with the superintendent a couple of times, one of the things I suggested was that when the students do work in the community, that they throw a little plaque on it, because most of the community has no idea the work that was done by the students. And I certainly wouldn't be offended by a little plaque that just says, you know, work was done by the Northeast Vocational students. There's several things in Reading, and there's 12 other communities where this work has been done, and they never take any credit for it.
Which is kind of counter to the whole purpose of doing it in the first place, right? So it's kind of like the phantom building.
But they also realize they have a limited amount of capacity, so they don't want to get too much to me. But, you know, the kids do a great job, and the school does a great job. They, like us, suffer from the same issue, which is we're so stretched with our time, we don't do a lot of marketing. You know, if the community was just aware of all the projects that were going on that the kids have helped out on, there'd be a much higher awareness and an appreciation, honestly, for what's a good Voc school and a lousy facility.
Good. Thank you, Bob. Mr. Brown.
To expand upon that a little bit, probably 4 or 5 years ago, I used them to make the little hooks that hold the flowers in place at the Memorial Day services. And that was some scrounging the signs at the old tennis court. So they cut them all up, made the hooks for us, a lot of hooks, them and the other vocational school in there. So they do the small things, too.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Mr. D'Addario.
Well, didn't they also do the renovation at the Matera Cabin?
They did some of it, yeah.
Fantastic. Any other public comment this evening? Okay. Thank you. Bob, any comments?
Just a couple. You certainly hit most of them, but library sub-bids and then, more importantly, the general contractor bids are in on the latter part of October. So your second selectmen's meeting in October, we should have the final word on that. And when we finalize the library building committee meeting, I think, unfortunately, it might be the same night as the Arcasa meeting on the 23rd. We'll invite one of the members to come if you so choose. As far as we know right now, everything is completely on track financially. There shouldn't be a problem. Until you get the bids, you never know. To follow up on a comment by John Halsey, next Monday, September 29th at 7 o'clock, the board will be posted, and that's when you'll have your discussion about Morton Field. So that's why you're posted for 7 o'clock at the Performing Arts Center. You'll be sharing the room with FinCom that's posted in the same location to have a different meeting, just so you know. On pages 8 and 9 of tonight's handouts, I won't go over anything that's been gone over with one exception, but on pages 8 and 9, on Monday, Jean and I attended a program with many of the Volk School communities, I might add, including Chelsea City Manager Jay Ash. And Chelsea was honored for the second time in their history, being awarded a designation of called an All-American City, which is a very unusual but rare designation. I think they give out 12 a year in the country. Jay invited me specifically and Redding specifically. And it was very unusual when I read through all the material. We're not a city. We're so different than Chelsea or any of the other entrants, pretty much. The winners this year, the ones that came to this, were recovering from some real difficult circumstances and real depressed economic areas. There was a place in Iowa that actually their city council formally adopted as a saying, will the last person out of such and such a town please turn the lights on? So that's how difficult they were. But as I sat and we sat and listened to the presentation, one of the things we've learned are lesser well-known and lesser publicized, there's cities and towns like Reading that are doing well, but then do better. And they could potentially get the designation. And the reason I bring this up is I don't think we have the bandwidth to formally participate in this, but a lot of things I learned and I saw is very similar to the Reading 2020 process the selectmen are going through. So it was really encouraging to see that. The one piece that was missing is there wasn't a lot of discussion about partnership. But I'll tell you, the saying that came out of the meeting that I won't forget anytime soon is, in God we trust, all others bring data. A variation of something many of us have heard in the past. One piece of news that you didn't cover, which is hard to believe the selectmen didn't miss something, but we're actually having an episode of Amish Renegades filmed in town. Any of you watch that on HGTV? They're renovating a house. I'm not supposed to say the address because I don't want it overrun. And if you see some Amish gentlemen and some film crew in town, you'll know why. There's not a date picked yet, but I believe that will be in the next couple weeks. And they were so taken by Reading as they drove around that they not only want to film the episode in the house that's being renovated, they want to do a lot of shots around town.
Oh.
So I thought that was interesting. Dan covered some of the grants. There's information on pages 11, 12, and 13. Within a 72-hour period, the town suddenly had a couple $1 million more than it had last week.
Nice.
And, win or lose, there's a lot of work that goes into grant applications, particularly by Erica and Arcasa and some of the school folks. They're not always successful. There's not always a reward to that. The work is just as hard. I give a lot of credit to all the folks that worked on the grant, and I think the key to all these grants is it was a collaborative effort, not just for the grant application, but the work product that's expected is school, town, and public. It's a three-legged stool. So the schools didn't get a grant to do just school things. The town didn't get a grant to do just town things. All three grants had an element of all the entire community, and that's probably why we got the grants, because we're one of the few towns, at least, that works at the level we do of collaboration. So I agree that the theme in the future is going to be more and more partnering, but internally we do a pretty nice job of that as it is, certainly better than most. That's all I have.
Do you have any idea, Bob, the number of grants? Maybe it's just an approximation that are actually submitted a year. I'm just curious.
Well, the Arcasa grant, statistically or numerically, we had a 10 or 12% chance of winning by raw applications. And for those that don't know, this is the same grant that Arcasa was originally founded on. Mm-hmm. There was a five-year grant with a five-year renewal, and we got both of those. But then we didn't get the renewal the first year, and so we went a year and a half and funded it on our own, and now we're given it. And I don't know, but I can only imagine the fact that the community stepped up and continued the work was a positive for the grant application that these people are serious. You know, this is work that's really important to them if they carry it forward anyways. The superintendent and I met this morning. We're going to have a discussion involving you and the school committee and the finance committee about what does this actually do to budgets and how does this actually
impact
it. We don't really know yet.
Right.
I will say that the expectation around our CASA is it's money already in the budget that the town has funded and now doesn't have to be funded. I think on the schools, I think there's a different picture. I think some of it is new money and new things, but there's also some existing money that could come out.
When do you think it would have that
conversation? I don't think we'll have that wrapped up for November town meeting, but we should have it for the spring or January.
Good, thank you. Well, as those of you who are watching tonight or in the room can see, it's a very, very busy Board of Selectmen and town staff and school staff that are working. And you see a little bit of it here when we start our meetings in the public liaison reports. We've almost gone an hour, and we haven't even started with our agenda. So this group, and I can speak for Bob and his team and the schools, are looking at every opportunity to improve, simplify, deliver a better Reading for ourselves and those that come after us. At this point, we have a report from Reading's Climate Advisory Committee. I see some of the members in the room, so perhaps they'd like to come forward.
Thank you. I'm David Williams, President and Chair of the Climate Advisory Committee. And we want to thank you for this opportunity to meet with you and discuss the activities and the report that we submitted to you earlier this year. This report was based on a lot of data from the United Nations report, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and also the Massachusetts Climate Change Adaptation Report, Union of Concerned Scientists, Changing Northeast Climate, and local reports such as the City of Boston Climate Action Plan Update. In making this report relatively concise, only 26 pages, and specific to Reading, we thank our town manager, police and fire chiefs, health director, water supply supervisor, and others for their time and information. You as selectmen realize a lot of work has gone into emergency preparedness for Reading. Climate adaptation is a longer range planning. Why adaptation? Climate certainly is changing, and it really is warming. The greenhouse gas CO2 is now up to 400 parts per million, which has never been before in our lifetime, and is still rising due to the burning of fossil fuel and decrease of forest areas. Warming increases the water content in the air, and so do violent storms and floods that continue. The average temperature also rises, as so do the extremes. We now may have 2 days above 100 degrees, but 28 days are projected by 2100. This is a significant heat stress on us, and specifically on our environment, more so on our environment. Sea temperature rise may be even more important, really. Seawater and ice are great heat sinks. As water volume increases, coastal flooding occurs. also water is great CO2 sink with decrease in coral and increase in acidity. From the UN report, if we do nothing, the temperature is expected to rise, as you see in the red line above me, with a shading indicating the probable variance. The black line is what we're doing up to the present time, and the blue line is based on the Kyoto Agreement to keep the temperature increased to 2 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial level. This agreement would have had the industrial nations decreasing greenhouse gas emissions, by 5% between 1990 and 2012. This didn't happen, and of course, China and India have been increasing their emissions as expected and outside the Kyoto Agreement. So if we do not do anything about mitigation, we better do something about adaptation. What would happen in terms of the migrating weathering patterns? This data would indicate that with moderate control, we follow the gold path above, and the situation would be similar to the climate in Pennsylvania. With present business as usual, we'd be following this red path, and that would indicate that the climate would be similar to that in the Carolinas. Certainly not bad for humans, who would be burning less fuel and getting more AC, but it would be a terrible effect on such things as, trees which don't move, and the fact that invasive species and the disease vectors which do move are very adaptable. On the right side, you can see the effect of the heat wave in 2012, and we didn't really feel the brunt of that heat wave. Okay, there are four things here. The young and elderly are certainly more susceptible to heat stroke. Ice storms are very often more devastating than snow, and floods are always a problem. But with rising sea levels and more water in the atmosphere, hurricanes and other major storms are likely to occur. Did I go backwards? No, okay. Okay, the hemlock tree doesn't move, but the woolly adelgid is moving, and recently Weston authorized $60,000 to buy Japanese ladybugs to eat this particular aphid. On the right side, the ubiquitous mosquito is a pest everywhere on the continent almost, but the present problem is, to us, eastern equine encephalitis and the West Nile virus. We don't want even more tropical diseases moving our way. Okay. Depending on where we are, there'll be either more, precipitation, large amounts, or perhaps longer drought periods. As our climate becomes more like the Carolinas, we can expect more heat waves, and so adaptation is critical. Whoops, okay. Hurricanes, tornadoes, and supercells. In our report, the disruption of power and sanitary services is reminiscent of the power outages in hospitals and deaths in New Orleans. Now some hospitals are being built with medical offices on the first two floors, power on the third floor, and beds on four and above. Sanitary services is reminiscent of the lack of porta potties, etc., in the evacuation center in the Superdome. Hopefully we are learning from these things, and certainly heat stress causes unnecessary deaths, especially among the young, disadvantaged, and elderly. Property damage is always a concern, but especially when the problem is widespread and fire and police protection become a problem in the local, in the near term. MEMA and FEMA and even the National Guard could be overwhelmed for a while. So rising levels will bring wetland degradation inland, especially along our riverbanks, but our neighbors on the coast will feel the most effect, and our dependence on seaports for fuel delivery really should be our concern also. We've already talked about the invasive species. In our report, we've looked at four key areas, bringing down the Massachusetts Climate Change Adaptation Report from 120 to hopefully less than 10, but we ended up with 26. Loss of habitat. This is a long-term project. Present animals, birds, and vegetation is both a forestry and a zoning problem as we allow building to shrink and break up native habitats. We're also not helping ourselves by bringing in non-native species that can become invasive. And we're adding to the problem by planting monolithic crops and diseases that can spread through the entire crop. This is also true of herds of cattle, flocks of chickens and any other things. Biodiversity really is important. Health and human welfare. Do we have a stock of materials, medicine, and antidotes for all eventualities? Probably not, and could we afford such a supply, or is it the citizen's responsibility? This is really an open question, but maybe it's the town's responsibility in the emergency shelters. And in the economy during a disaster, it's not going to be good. Local government needs to be prepared with auxiliary help, and this is going to take money away from present projects that also have merit. It's time to think about the future risk versus benefit versus the present cost of benefit. And key infrastructure is really key. Local government, this includes the roads, bridges, and buildings, but also the water and sewer line upkeep and generators in key places. This would include near gas pumps at service stations. Without electricity, gasoline becomes unavailable, and evacuation stalls. Can the town subsidize or provide emergency equipment? We do a pretty good job of providing subsidies for electrical and water usage, decreasing it. Could we do the same for emergency equipment? And what can we do? One thing that the individual can do, of course, is to have a kit at home and in the car with whatever is necessary for their particular needs, certainly food, water, and medicine, and to see your town website and the Chief Burns information there. We need evacuation plans with primary and alternate routes to specific destinations. For stay-in-place emergency, we need alternative forms of energy. Gas diesel generators on the ready would be very important. Solar, geothermal, and wind would be good at any time. But biomass, as I see it, includes wood and a way to burn it on site. Finally, know your emergency signals. There are a lot of them, but the intermittent blasts mean take cover and listen for instructions. Many people, I don't think, know that. There we go. Okay, now think about your family needs. If you're going to bring cans, bring a can opener, and credit cards may not work, so have some cash on hand. Other things are listed in these kit statements, and it's best to follow those instructions. Get the word out. That's what we're trying to do in this presentation and also in our Green Sense articles and other things. There we go. We've also been involved with the school system and RMLD in terms of trying to work with them and we should know the primary and secondary shelters. Apparently, the primary shelter is now, according to our, is now the senior center. Do we know who our at-risk neighbors are, and could and should we know it? Should the town meeting members be somehow involved in this process? We may have a lot of people that are at risk. We should know and help. Plant trees and reduce asphalt amounts. Rain barrels and organic waste composters are probably worth having in place as emergency measures, as well as conservation measures. Now may a good time to be for me included to get started using them. I don't have a rain barrel because I don't feel it necessary in the short term. In the long term, maybe. Bottom line. We need to think about the long term. And this includes climate change. However, the climate change is changing, and so are our conditions. A lot of our conditions now are changed from when I was here 50 years ago, when our sewage ended up in our front lawn in a septic system that worked very well. Now it doesn't even stop in Reading, you know. Our water came from the Reading wells. Now it comes from Quabbin Reservoir, although thankfully we can still use our wells in an emergency. We're becoming far more dependent on others, and we've been talking here about the help that we've had from other areas, but we were expecting to be helpful in response to that. But in the times of regional disaster, some of these problems may backfire. We believe adaptation without mitigation will be insufficient to eliminate climate change, but with mitigation and adaptation, we can probably avoid the more serious consequences of global warming. And we can do our bit to influence the state and federal legislatures, which hopefully would influence other world leaders, because the United States is not necessarily at the forefront of this. But it is time for local emergency planning, and probably for small decisions, such as NIPAP, vote for the expanded bottle bill to save hydrocarbons. And we have mitigation and adaptation in one package. It would be nice if we could have solar cooling. Could it be in our town, and could it be on town property? I know that if we looked at that, at present it doesn't look good, but in the future it might. So thank you for your attention, and we would take comments and questions for the remaining time.
David, thank you for your comments. The Reading Conservation Group has long been active, Climate Advisory Committee has long been active in Reading, and I appreciate your comments tonight regards readiness. How are you getting the word out, besides tonight, of course, how are you?
Well, certainly one thing is the Green Sense articles, which come out every week in the local papers. That's very helpful, I think. We're also involved with anything that happens in the town, such as the various Friends and Family Day and the Earth Day celebration, which we had at Madeira Cabins. And also, I think, with help with the school, not maybe the school committee, but individual teachers.
Sure.
And the RMLD, which we have good liaison with. We appreciate that also.
Good. Thank you.
Those are the areas that I can think of.
Well, and I'm good. John, that's the problem. I mean, we don't, the word needs to get out.
Yeah.
And we're, looking, we have talked to the police chief, because he's done a great job, and what we're trying to do is, you know, we're looking, and that has been difficult in getting the word out. A lot of people, our ladies do a great Green Sense every week. They get an article out in both papers, but not everybody reads it. So it's our report is on the website. It's been, but again, not everybody's going to read it. So that's one reason why we did the report and trying to get the word out. And I mean, it's kind of amazing that we're doing it tonight, because it was the People's Climate March with 310,000 people this Sunday in New York.
And he was there.
I happened to be there, because without me, it would have been 310,000, and I'm glad to do it. Secondly, there's a climate summit going on right now at the United Nations. President Obama spoke today. And now we have our adaptation report, the big three. I just hope we didn't steal the president's thunder. But yeah, we're looking at it as I think the world is starting to see it. And how do we start to make change? We have to adapt for what's already happening and what's going to happen. If we go to zero carbon emissions today, the next 10 to 20 years, it's still good. Our temperature is still going to rise, because that carbon that we emit today takes about 10, 20 years to have effect in the environment. So we could stop today for 10, 20 years, we're going up. So what we're experiencing today was emitted 10 years ago. So this is why we're looking to avert what could be some serious trouble. We've had tornadoes now coming close to us. You know, and we're not saying, we're saying that extreme weather, the kind of weather we might have gotten is just becoming a little bit more serious. It's become faster, we get a little bit more of them. And, you know, so things are getting dangerous. We're trying to sound the alarm and try to see if we can do something to adapt, but also realize that if we keep business as usual and we don't mitigate, that adaptation won't take care of it.
Thank you. Any other board members have comments? Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Great report, by the way. Thank you very much for your efforts putting that together.
Thank you very much, all of you. We appreciate it. Thank you.
See you. We're about 10 minutes behind schedule, but we have now a hearing from the Town Forest Committee regards rules and regulation. Dan, do you have a...
Yeah, to the inhabitants of the Town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on September 23rd, 2014 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on the following Town Forest Committee rules and regulations, 7:50 p.m. Copies of the proposed documents regarding this topic are available in the town meeting, town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, Monday through Wednesday and Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. 5:30, it's obscured there. Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m. and are attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by mail prior to 6 p.m. on September 23rd, 2014, to town manager at ci.reading.ma.us.
Very good. Thank you, Dan. No, this is a hearing notice.
I just opened it.
Do we have a presentation?
There's something on the desktop that just vanished. I'll go find it.
All right. In our packages on Thursday was the read-ahead copy.
Yeah, and also tonight on pages, page 15 has the current, if you will, rules of the town forest, mm-hmm. and 16 and 17 are suggested revisions, and I'll go call that up as we're speaking. I just did want to call to attention, when town council looked this over a week or two ago, 13 was the only question. 13 is probably not something that falls under the purview of the town forest committee to enforce any fines. Otherwise, the other 18 clauses, if you will, were legally sound. So I would invite the Town Forest Committee to come up and discuss the new rules, and I'll get those up in the background.
Any members here from the Town Forest Committee?
Yeah. Yes.
Come on up. Why don't you come on up?
Yeah.
Those are the cheap seats. These are much more.
I think it'd be helpful if you folks went through the process. I know that at some point going back a year or so, there was some discussion about some town forest rule changes. Some of the Boy Scouts showed up. There was some discussion about communication From where I sit, albeit at quite a distance, what I've heard is all the parties involved are extremely happy and very satisfied with the process you use. So I think you should just let the board know that, because they may not know that.
Sure. I think we have a lot of confusion originally because we tried to get every possible rule or regulation that was already out there from similar groups, and we compiled about a 4 or 5 page list that governed these guys, or as a in facto. So we had to start the process all over again, eventually, and all the groups came. We probably talked about a year, I think, as you can see with the voice here in writing. And I thought it was very amicable, because we had groups that would sit at the meeting and pass their own ideas back and forth. We had a lot of the Boy Scouts. We had a lot of the dog walking groups. We had bird watchers a lot. And just the people who just went out and just enjoyed the forest, just for the forest being itself. So we didn't really, I think, end up changing a lot drastically. If you look at the original rules and the ones that we settled up with, we had a few more, we adjusted a few, but essentially we just tweaked it to make it a little more fitting for today's time.
If I might add, the response by Ray Miares, we welcome all the input we can get in this process, and I think somehow the draft regulations that we've submitted to you were taken as an authority to impose fines, which we don't see our role as being at all. It seemed to me there may be some straightforward wording corrections that would simply identify the term violation of these rules and regulations may be punished by fines as administered by the Reading Police and Fire Departments, such as in the case of dumping, vandalism. We wouldn't say this, but it would be understood. Dumping, vandalism, nuisance, disturbance of the peace, things of that sort that you would find in any terrain within Reading that would fall under the purview of the police department or fire department in terms of administering public safety. So I think the legal counsel's assumption that we're seeking to impose authority or fines is not our intention at all. And so this wording would ideally correct that.
Is there a latent issue or a chronic issue that is evident regards fine assessment? Has there been a historical issue that you're aware of that fines was meant to address?
That's a great question.
I'm not aware of it.
I have a number of comments, but just going to that point specifically, it's a great idea, but that's typically something you would use for a chronic and regularly occurring incident, like a parking violation or parking enforcement, which you have hundreds of people, you've got a... It's difficult to train people, so this is a means to penalize the behavior. It doesn't appear there's such an issue here in the least.
The only thing I could think of was, in a number of such town forests as nearby as the Middlesex Fells, there have been some deliberate fires set. So under arson provisions, there would be concern. In fact, we did have a couple of mysterious origin local brush fires in the past.
Sure, but no fine's going to stop that or address it. It's a different remedy.
Yeah? Maybe more to the point, the remedy's already in the law.
Another point.
Right. Yeah.
So you don't need to repeat it.
Yeah. The current regulations cover the town forest along with everything else, so it's sort of redundant to put this in here.
I'm not sure it helps. I think you've got all the belts and suspenders you need. I understand the intent and the good purpose it serves, but the nature of the use, it's almost self-policing. You've got so many different folks through there. Citizen eyeballs and citizen ears are probably more effective than any threat of black
letters. I think particularly the Boy Scouts or the dog walkers as a group.
Those dog walkers, boy, I mean, they get into something there.
Well, I think the purpose was to have these posted, because there's been some concern, particularly about off-road vehicles in the town forest.
Mm-hmm.
And when dog walkers have told people they're not allowed to do that, they say, well, where's the posting? So this is to really enforce what the rules are and to say that there are fines if you violate the rules. Otherwise, there's very little oomph besides posting, that was the hope.
I'm guessing that since a fine takes a while to impose, and which the example you gave, Nancy, was something you want something more immediate, I suppose. Somebody's in that situation.
But rules post it, so people know that they can't take, their cars into the town forest after school. That's all. I mean, that's
so
just one
example.
There's
no postings right now?
Well, that's...
There's nothing really there, and whatever goes up there gets pulled down occasionally. So we're talking about putting a nice solid kiosk with a lock to it.
Many of our...
Post things inside.
Many of our...
And then we would laminate the rules and put them in there. And putting them at the end of Stroud Avenue and also over by the river.
And Tim sent me that today.
Many of our parks, like Memorial Park, I know, has such a declaration up front. It's in a nice sturdy 4x4 PT timber. Is that kind of what you're talking about at the entrance
right.
to the park?
There's also things we could use it for. We could put up warnings about bacteria in the water,
yep.
the dogs, and just the danger is of dog waste going to the Ipswich River. So we could do a lot of public service things like that on that, too.
My only thought is think about enforcement actions that aren't tied to fines, which have a long time to take effect, and maybe there's a different remedy for a violation, like I don't know, make a phone call or self-enforcement.
Isn't there one in here at the one of the last ones in regards to that that you town forced can impose what
19?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. If it's a group, then you can
yeah. Future use.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's a right. It's really, I'm guessing it's not the groups that you have a problem.
No,
it's the individuals.
It's the outliers.
Yeah.
It's the strays that come in. I'm guessing the Boy Scouts and the dog walkers
the
are.
Problem.
I think guardians of the place because
right.
they use it so much.
Well, the feeling we had is the responsible people are showing up at the meetings.
Yeah,
sure. Those who don't care are fine.
Right.
Showing up.
But you can post these rules and have the rules up there without this one thing in here about violations and lead to fines.
Yes.
You can clearly point to it, they're not allowed, you know. So
you can put a picture of a very angry dog.
Or several of them. Yeah. The only other comment I had is I went through the document. There are four or five cases where the same spirit, I'm not talking about content, just structure, the same spirit is in multiple entries. For example, number two speaks to any alteration, construction, or other work shall require written permission. Number four says no person shall cut, break, remove, deface. It strikes me that you could potentially combine those two. Likewise, five and six. One is discharge of firearms, the second is no hunting. The third is 10 and 11, where no dumping, littering, or filling in. And 11 reads, users must carry out everything that they carry in, which is almost the desired outcome of not dumping, not littering, not filling. So from a straight, one of the reasons the original, I think, document was seven rules long is it attempted to consolidate these into bigger thoughts. And this is no different, but it accomplishes it with a greater spend of words than you might otherwise want to construct. Likewise, 7 and 17. The town forest is closed to motor vehicles. 17 reads, approved vehicles as follow designated roads only. Those are very complementary thoughts that you could bring together in one statement.
I think that one is specific to groups.
Yeah,
it's the car thought.
We broke things up is because something pertained to groups, something pertained to everybody.
That's fair.
But
that's fair.
I think your point of like 4, 5, 6, and 7, we had talked many times about it. It kind of became one big statement and broke up back and forth
yeah.
a number of times.
Just a style thing. Some of this is style, but as you think about it as readability and comprehension, less is more sometimes.
I think to John's point, you're going to want people to, you're going to mount these, you're going to put them for reading. Sometimes less is more. You get the same message into fewer bullet points, and I'm not trying to wordsmith you here, but I know if I walk in and see three pages of things to read or you know, something that's a little more concise, I'm probably
also
more likely.
We had a big paragraph, then we just skip it all together and go to the shorter one.
Yeah, that's
so
possible, too.
It was a lot of debate about that.
Yep. Well, it sounds like you guys have thought it through.
Yes.
You know,
this is a far cry from where you started, I thought.
Yeah,
so.
I am judging your success by the complete lack of emails that I'm getting on the subject.
Nobody's complaining.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, you've done your job. Yeah.
So this is a hearing, so we're looking for the board's approval. I guess the only question is regards 13.
You want to close it first? Or?
Did you want to ask for a public comment?
We will, but I think the only question is how do we resolve the issue in 13, Bob, with regard to closing and moving forward?
I suggest you delete it.
That's what I was there.
Okay.
Any subsequent need for a fine if it doesn't exist in the bylaw, which I think what Ray is saying is that should be in the town bylaws. Specific responsibility for a specific
or conservation should adopt something
similar.
Yeah, conservation is able to fine, town forest is not.
Right.
Other groups can fine.
Conservation could put a posting in your kiosk.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The conservation only controls some parts of the park.
Right.
Not, right.
So that's another issue.
There's a lot of non-wetland.
Jeff?
Mr. Chair, just a quick comment. We'll be, obviously, DPW is working with the Town Forest Committee. In fact, the process, as you know, is if someone wants to use the Town Forest, they come into Public Works, we have a login sheet where they log in. We've had, I think, up to a dozen groups have used it since April. We've got, I think, two more scheduled in October. But they log in, we give them a copy of the rules and regulations, and then we send them to the Town Forest Committee to get their blessing when they go in, so we know exactly who's there all the time. And then going forward, we'll be working with the group. You know, the kiosk is one thing they asked that we could maybe provide some help with. Also, there's the doggy
waste station.
Waste station that, you know, we could help put up. So we'll be working with them on that. They've got a small budget, as you know, that they can use for material and so forth. So.
Sounds like an Eagle Scout project.
I was going to say, that sounds ideal for an Eagle Scout project.
Volunteers, I brought that up actually to the...
And we got a vocational school that would love to build some.
Actually, I want to point out, we've had an amazing surge of Eagle projects in Town Forest. We probably have four or five projects going on right now. Just finishing, I think once we have a lot of time, we're going to put together a list of them. But very, very impressive how the Boy Scouts have...
Well, just as a sidebar, that's, you know, of the 56 towns and communities that are governed by the Boston Minuteman Council, Reading continues year after year to have more Eagle Scouts than
we're doing
any
something
of those,
right,
including Boston. Mm-hmm.
I'm impressed by how many of them are raising funds for things like bridges and so forth in the local community. Funds
there, that's the job. That's what they're supposed to do.
So raise the money, manage the project.
So I do have one question. So on number two, any alteration, construction, or other work in the town forest shall require prior written permission from the town forest committee. So would that include any town work that might need to be done in the town forest? Because it seems to me there might be times that the town needs to do work.
Do something, but we would go to the committee just to, obviously, as a matter of fact.
But does that need subject to the town forest approval, or is it?
I mean, that
you need to clean, you know, you can hypothetically come up with a case where you need to do something and there's disagreement about how to do it.
Right.
How does that get?
Mostly talking about maybe maintenance on the roads.
Yeah.
You know, talk about stuff around the compost area or?
Maintenance area, maintenance issues are stuff you're talking about.
You could imagine, you can invent any such example. What I'm saying is this says you'll get written permission from Town Forest if the town itself has an opinion what to do, what trumps what? Did you have a thought, Bob?
I was just going to say, if there's an emergency, we wouldn't remember the town forest committee had rules. We'd fix it.
Right.
I mean, that's the basic rule of emergency.
If it's not an urgent,
but if it's not an emergency,
if it isn't, this says the town forest committee will decide.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Whether you want that or not.
I'm just wondering if it should be town forest committee or board of selectmen, which then covers it more broadly. I don't know.
I mean, one consideration is our mandate is within Department of Public Works, so we're in effect a kind of arm of DPW. Not on the payroll, obviously.
Same as they are.
You're going to get a doubling in your salary too.
How does the board feel, to Marcy's point? How does the board? We'll talk more about this in the deliberation, but I think the question is: should there be a path for the selectmen to participate in any of this or not?
I don't see a need at this time. If at some point in the future, you know, much as we went through on the
last go
the reuse bylaw of the historical commission, there's a need to get us involved. Great. If not, I'd just press these good folks to do their thing.
Okay. Is there any public comment tonight? Gina.
Gina Snyder, David Terrace. I just wanted to thank the Town Forest Committee for all the good work they did. They really brought a lot of diverse opinions together. I did want to speak to your comment about the number of paragraphs and how things are parsed out. And one of the issues was to make it clearer that the seven rules weren't working. The police were saying, we can't do anything, there's no rule about it. So I think the more critical aspect of it, of the rules are, is to be able to get the authorities in there for some of the stuff that was going on that needed to be stopped, the ATV, some, I guess you are allowed to have a gun in a canoe down the river, but you can't come on to town forest land with your gun or your bow and arrow. To make that very clear, I think is really what the issue was, that started this all off.
I see. Thank you for clarifying. Is there another hand I saw?
Yes. So, in regards to what you have as far as...
Would you introduce yourself?
Sorry. Todd Beatron, Temple Street.
Hi, Todd.
As far as to number five and the other, number six, the hunting, I mean, number five clearly doesn't cover arrows, blowguns, slingshots, trapping, snares. I mean, they're not probably used a lot today, but they could be. And, you know, so no, hunting covers that. And you don't want people doing go out to the forest to do their practice. You know, I don't have a property of mine where I can do target shooting, so I'm going to go out to the town forest and set up a target and do my practice skeet shooting. So I think having those two separated adds a lot of clarification to laws.
Yep. Thank you. Any other comments?
Is the compost area considered part of the town forest?
Don't know.
It is.
There's the water, the wells, there's the compost area, and then there's the town forest.
Okay, so
those two areas are separate.
So number 10 will not prohibit people taking their leaves up to the compost center.
Very clever.
Very good. We don't need any amendments there.
In fact, we encourage people, if they're going to be having a fire out there like Boy Scouts, they can go to the compost area and get the wood out of there.
Right.
So they don't bring invasive species in.
All right. Close the hearing.
Yes, sir. Move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing amending the Town Forest Committee rules and regulations.
Do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Any discussion? All those in favor of closing the hearing? 5-0.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the Town Forest Committee rules and regulations as amended.
Do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Discussion?
So are we amending it by removing 13?
Is that the even so? Move, or I can make the motion to exclude that if that's agreeable to everyone. I will amend the motion it says as amended, then we can just make the amendment.
Okay.
That's the cleaner way to do it.
So you need a motion to amend the rules?
Yes, I will move to strike Rule 13 and renumber the subsequent sections accordingly.
Okay, do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand.
It's the amendment.
The amendment, excuse me.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now to the primary motion. Mm-hmm. All those in favor of the primary motion of accepting the rules as amended, 5-0.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for your work.
Thank you.
And we do appreciate the fact that we weren't inundated with many,
yes.
many emails, which is what happened.
It's a much better situation.
Right.
So wind it down.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have another hearing. Again, we're running a bit late on an order of taking for Belmont Street as it relates to water easements. Dan.
Yes, in the absence of the Town of Reading, please take notice of the Board of Selectmen. The Town of Reading will hold a public hearing on September 23, 2014 in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on the following order of taking, 87 and 93 Belmont Street water easements, 8:15 p.m. Copies of the proposed documents regarding this topic are available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and are attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on September 23rd, 2014, to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us.
You know, if this doesn't work out, you can always be one of those guys at the end of the car commercials that does that last 20 seconds.
I'm trying.
George.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This is the next to last step in acquiring a water easement that's required for our current water project that's going to improve the water quality and increase fire flow in the Libby Ave area of our distribution system. First step was actually to have a town meeting vote, which occurred last spring, I'm sorry. This step here is for the board to approve the order taking. Then that the order taking and plans will be recorded in the registry of deeds. And the final step will actually be to make the award for the damages. The water easement itself, if you look at the attached plan I have on the board, which is
in between the two properties of 87 and 93 Belmont. It's over an existing water and sewer easement. We currently have a water and sewer easement there. What you're actually voting is to increase, to add to the use of existing water, drainage and sewer easement, the use of water. We're not increasing the existing easement area. We're just adding one additional use to allow us to install and repair water main. We had the easements appraised by Evergreen Appraisals prior to town meeting. The appraisals for the damages came in at $200 a piece, and I have a copy of the appraisals here that if you do want to see.
Is there a plan or a date by which the water addition would be made?
It's under construction right now in the Libby Ave area. Through our order of conditions, for the portion of the water main that goes through the wetland over here, we do have to do that during the dry season. It is possible that the contractor may ask us, we'd in turn ask the Conservation Commission, assuming that the conditions are favorable, to actually perform that work in the winter months. Because sometimes winter months are even sometimes more favorable than trying to do it in the dry season. So short of that occurring, the water main actually wouldn't get installed until next summer.
Okay.
Towards the tail end of the project.
The project itself
that was just started, bids were opened back in June. It's currently underway. It's an 18-month, 20-month construction period, so they'll still be working on this next year.
Thank you, George. Any comments from the board? Questions? Is there anyone here from the affected properties? Kevin, I'm sorry.
The easement itself, what is that? What land is that actually going through? That's splitting the two parcels?
It's splitting the two parcels. This line right here, which is approximately, it is in the middle, one except for once you get near the end of the properties.
Uh-huh.
This is the property line to 87 and 93 Belmont.
Okay.
So there's 10 feet on each side. It does sort of flare out a little bit towards the end as we approach the drainage easement where the existing brook is.
What currently sits on that parcel?
Right now you have the drainage brook that's in the back that we have the existing drainage easement that we have a rights to. Our main sewer interceptor comes up through here. And there's a line that comes out towards Belmont Street that carries all the sewerage in the easement. When they took the sewer easement, the Board of Public Works at that time took the easement for sewer and drainage. And that was back in the 50s or something like that, I forget exactly.
And so there's no like driveways or sheds?
There's a planting area in here, and we have in the contract to replace the plantings and the trees. The driveway to 93 Belmont is on the left-hand side, 87. It's on the left-hand side of the house, but it's a little bit further away from the easement. The way we have our contract documents is anything that gets damaged by the contractor has to get restored to our satisfaction, not his. And obviously our satisfaction is going to be, as long as the homeowner is satisfied, then we're satisfied.
And the black easement that we're talking about here already exists in the same form and shape?
Yes. The heavy line that's right here is the extent of
the current
portion that we're asking for the added use for water, but underlying that is an existing sewer and drain easement also, yes.
So you're really just running a pipe, another pipe?
It's another
pipe.
We're
running another pipe, and we're expanding the use of an existing easement. We're not expanding the area.
And so the goal really is, I mean, the 10 feet on either side of that pipe is for when you're doing work.
The 10 feet from each side of the property line, that's the limits of the easement.
Right.
The sewer line right now probably is just to this side of the property line. The water main is going to be coming in down the property.
So my point is you're not really engaging the two homeowners' property other than as needed to repair.
That's correct.
Okay.
And those lines are the exact lines of the easement today.
Yes.
There's no new impairment.
There's no
we're not obtaining any additional area of an easement.
Okay.
Isn't there an additional area at the end by the stream?
Sir, could you introduce yourself?
Pardon? I'm 87 Belmont.
Thank you.
No, because the existing sewer easement comes up here and goes this way.
Yes.
The drainage easement is from this line over to here. So this whole portion is a drainage easement. This drain easement, this whole portion that in between the 20 feet and between this area is a sewer easement. So from this dash line to the street, it's actually a drain and a sewer easement. This last 15 feet is only a drainage easement.
Chris White from 93. I was trying to understand. It looked like there was a dotted line where that flare is. Like, what does that represent? Is that an old line? Like,
is that the current easement?
Right there?
This line right there?
It looks like you kind of flared it. I just don't know.
We flared it because
It doesn't.
The sewer line's coming over here, and to avoid something, to avoid some issues that avoid a tree that the Conservation Commission didn't want us to take down. As we're crossing the brook, we have to angle off to the edge of our sewer, of our easement going through the wetlands. So we couldn't just follow straight here. We had a flare out here within the existing easement to make sure we had room to allow the contractor to do this.
That's not additional, that's not taking additional?
No, because if
this
total width right here is the existing drain easement.
I see.
The easements overlap.
For the drainage ditch?
Yes. For the drainage brook that's behind your house.
For
this portion of the drainage ditch is actually classified a river. It's the far property line of yours is where it becomes a drainage swale.
The discussion took place in front of the Conservation Commission about 5 years ago as to whether that was a river or not, and it was declared by the Conservation Commission that it was a drainage ditch.
Well, to be very brief, the first definition of what you classify a river or a drainage, what you classify a river in the Chapter 131, which is the wetland regulations, is the shading of a blue line. If it's a dark blue line, it's a river. On a dark blue line on the USGS sheets, it's a river. If it's a lighter blue line, it could be a river or it could be an intermittent stream. Beyond that, you have to do a bunch of hydraulic calculations when it's really indeterminate. The problem is, unless these two colors are right next to each other, it's very hard to figure out which one's a dark blue line and which one's a light blue line. But you can clearly see, if you look at a USGS map, that once you get to the left-hand property line of 93 Belmont, the color changes from a darker blue to a light blue. And that's the first distinction. You can go through a series of very involved, detailed calculations, which DEP will give you will probably dispute, because their first regulation says it's a river if it's a dark blue one. And it's very hard to go against what the DEP, what the Chapter 131 state regulations say. But it is a river up to that point, to furthest point, which was one of the additional mitigations that we had to do when we did the conservation pilot for the project.
Good to know.
Yeah, which means that within 200 feet of the top of the bank,
your house couldn't be.
Is within conservation jurisdiction, unfortunately. That means even your front yard.
Any other comments from the homeowners?
Pardon?
Any other comments?
Yes, George has left one thing off of there, or two things off of that drawing. If you go to the beginning of the driveway,
which is on your property or?
Between the two properties. Approximately 3 feet from the property, 3.5-4 feet from the property line, along the property line up the center there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a telephone pole.
Yes.
And another foot inside the property line is an anchor.
The property corner, when we had walked the site, there's a iron pipe, I believe, or a pin up here. There's another one on the far side of the back side of the planting area. And then there's another one that's three quarters of the way down your property line. We've located all those. We have them tied to all the stone bounds and the roadway layout in our survey, which determines your property. And those are all going to be reset by my department upon the completion of the
work. I understand that. My initial concern, however, is based upon the telephone pole and the guy and the anchor that's there.
The guy what?
How are you going to get equipment in?
Without
trespassing.
We'll probably have to have the pole supported, or we might have to temporarily remove the pole. In order to do the work. It's not a problem construction-wise. We do it all the time. I don't want to make it sound menial, but it's something that's done all the time when you're doing underground construction.
The only question I had was just you came up with a number of reimbursement, and it was equal for both sides for the work to be done to compensate for so forth. I mean, I don't know where that number came from. It's just.
I provided you a summary. I can provide the entire appraisal.
It was equal, a little more, bit more.
This is
square footage on my side than his. How does that happen?
You're correct. I mean, when you're looking at the water damages for an easement, it does go by area. The areas in these two cases there's not a big difference. There's about a 60 square foot difference in area. So what the appraisal looks at, it looks at what type of property, what the use of the property, and they go through and find a lot of comparable values, and they arrive at a square foot value of the land and whatnot, and depending on what the use of the easement is going to be, and obviously the fact that there was an existing easement there, it's the value of the ward is probably less than what it would be if there was no easement there at all. If there was no easement there at all and we were going to take a brand new easement, the value of the ward would have been higher.
So to go right down the middle, there's a couple of beautiful trees there and two monster rhododendrons.
The rhododendrons we will remove and we'll try replanting if both of you want them replanted. The trees, we've talked to the tree warden. They're the type of species that don't sit well for being temporarily displaced and then replanted. So it's in the contract to replace the trees.
What diameter?
I believe it's a 4-inch caliper. I would have to verify that.
They're a good 18 inches right now.
We can try salvaging them, but the tree warden does not believe they will survive.
Oh, I don't believe they would either.
If there were different species, they may, but the species that were there does not believe they'll survive. And if there's, two or three trees?
Two.
We can put more.
How big can you go in terms of the caliper?
I believe we'll do whatever the residents want. I believe the intent was to have a similar species of, or at least a similar variety.
They're both crabs.
Crabs and everything. You can only get them so large.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what we can do.
But we could get as large as we can possibly get. We'll scour around and find out what we can get. We have the leeway in the contract, so.
It's known already that the trees will be damaged based on, or is it just a general?
It's in order to get these installed, all of the plantings that are, basically right here in the middle, and they probably go beyond
I see.
These.
The water line is right down the center of the
Right.
The tree that's farther from the street.
I think you had a picture of it.
There's no way to, it's impossible to get around them. The only way we could get around them is actually to expand the area of the easement.
Yeah, that just doesn't really do it justice, you know, what's there.
Right, this is just, this isn't the construction drawing, this is just the drawing to establish what the lines of the easement.
Yeah, so it's definitely a.
I have a question now.
Yes, John.
Would you two guys be better off, would you be more interested in a wider easement in the idea of preserving the plantings and the trees?
I guess that my question was to put in a water, there's a drainage, and I don't know anything about this stuff, but drainage and sewage, to put in a water easement, is that just like a, like you can just do that? There's no question of saying whether you can or can't put in a water easement? Or is that just like, you have drainage and sewer, you just now want to put in water? Is there a choice on that, or is that?
We have the easement for drainage and sewer. The only thing that's installed in that easement right now is sewer. The likelihood of drainage being installed, I don't want to say never, because you never know what's happening, but based on the fact.
There is drainage installed there.
There is the outfall. I take it back. I'm sorry. You're correct. I forgot there was a basin that went out there. One of the reasons why this location was chosen is we have to get to the end of Libby Ave, and this is actually the narrowest point of a wetland that we have to cross. I mean, Libby Ave area is basically one large peninsula that's surrounded by wetland, and there's really no other way in there. And this portion from your rear yards to Ivy Street in the end is the narrowest portion to make that crossing. And actually at the time, we had plans in the office when, you know, back well before I came here, before I even started here 8 years ago, that the town actually thought there was an existing water easement there. It was for all utilities. And it wasn't until we started designing this project that we went to the registry, found the recorded document, and we determined that at that time it was only sewer and drain and didn't include water. That's why we're going through and getting this at a late stage in the project. Otherwise, when we went for the easement, going through the Conservation Commission, we would have obtained it then, but we didn't even know it at that time. At that time, we thought that this easement also was for all utilities. Mm.
Mr. White, Mr. Halsey asked a question. I'm not sure if you thought about it, would you prefer to have the?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I'd want to expand an easement, unless.
I get when you plant something and get something growing and it's been going there for a long time,
you
you're
may
used to it that way.
It's,
I mean,
like their thing, and the wife's like saying they're going to chop those down. That didn't fly so well, but
is there a visual barrier between the two houses?
And
yeah, I get it.
Like, instead of a fence, but it's a net,
we,
and, you know,
much better than a fence.
And they're beautiful, yeah. Spring and all that
it's
stuff.
It's a friendly fence.
Yeah.
And they've been there. So, you know, and that's why I was like, it's kind of doesn't really do it justice showing this. But, and that's why I also didn't know. I mean, as far as easements and so forth, I didn't know if there was, hey, we want to put in a, you don't have a choice, we're going to put in a water easement. First of all, so that I didn't know if that's like something that I had an option of saying, if I don't want you to put in a water easement, do I have that option?
Town meeting voted it, and it has eminent domain.
It's designated domain.
If necessary.
Like, no,
yeah.
We're putting one in, then it's like the $200 is just for what we thought was
the value of
the
extra.
The value
use.
For, you know, coming through. And I've had stakes in the yard since January, so I'm kind of going.
When's
you
it going to start?
Yeah, you know, I had them hammer it down to the ground so the kids don't run into it
right.
When they're running for a
right.
Deep pass. But, and, you know, and just trying to get a handle of, like, what's going on, when the thing's done, and when they're going to put in new trees, what's going to be replaced and so forth. So that's just trying to get more information.
Sure, thank you. George.
Mr. Chairman, just to answer the question, it is possible to go around the plantings, but it definitely would require a wider easement.
That's why I asked the question. I mean, you know,
if
the plantings and the trees are more valuable to you as they are.
Well, you'd chew up his driveway and you'd wipe out my big burning bush.
Well, the burning bush is probably easier to transplant. I mean, and yes, we would go through his driveway and would have to. I personally, I don't like digging a trench through someone's driveway or to this extent here. We would completely redo your entire driveway. I mean, it's a whole driveway right now, and it's in good condition. It's not in disrepair, and you know, to put it back in a condition that it is now, it would require to completely replace your driveway.
Now, what type of trees were they again? Did you say?
Crab apples.
Crab apples.
Right.
Is that
pretty mature?
Okay.
They've been there.
Which one of those?
This is the first one.
1972.
They've probably been there before that.
They get to be about 20 feet when they're mature at the most, right?
20 feet high. Well, we pretty much kept them trimmed down, but they're at least 20 feet wide.
Is there a different type of tree that you'd like to see in this place that's similar? That's a low growing tree that still provides barrier, but you know, that natural fence. You know, maybe
that's a good question. I'm curious,
there's a lot of flowering trees that are low growing trees similar to a crab apple.
What type of thing you can plant on
top of
a pipe?
You're going to give us some of those pears that are around town that break in every storm?
Got one of those.
George, is a question about the depth.
Just to answer Mr. White's comment, actually what our easement says is you can't put any plantings on top of it, our existing drainage and sewer easement. But they're there, and you know, we have no intention of not putting them back. We do plan on putting them back. The thing is with the newer technology, in most cases, you do not have to go back in and redig to repair a pipe. I mean, if you had to increase the size, you would have to go back in. Our water main, if the water main does break, you have to excavate it to repair it.
Of course.
Sewer lines and drain lines, it has to be a pretty severe break to actually go in and excavate. A lot of the repairs we could do for the internally now with sewer and drain lines. So in 85% to 90% of the problems that we may have to do with maintenance of the drain lines, maybe all the utilities, once we put this pipe in, we won't have to dig again.
There was a question, or at least a line of thought, is there some latitude in terms of replacement species?
We'll put in anything. I mean, we had to put in a type of species in the contract. You know, if the value of the species obviously is cost of the contractor a lot more, would have to issue a change order for the contractor to do the difference in cost. But that's such a minor cost to a $2 million project. It's 0.1% probably, so it's not an issue. We can put any species.
So just as Mr. Halsey's suggestion to examine alternatives for location, there may be a chance here to examine alternatives to species. If you're tired of burning bush and it's the 1972, is time to do a change up.
No, that one's not getting touched.
That was if you expanded it.
Right. Just hypothetically, you have that some latitude.
And you
there.
Can't buy those anymore.
You're right. You can't.
You're right.
True.
It's hard to kill them, though.
Oh, yes.
They're invasive species.
Any other questions?
You can buy them, but you have to go out of state and smuggle them back in. Oh.
So, John, if I may, I think that, I have a similar kind of thing between my neighbor and I have been together for 25 years, and, you know, those kinds of, barriers are kind of nice, actually, and especially among friendly neighbors. And so, if you guys want to figure out what you'd rather have there, assume for a minute you can't have what you have, or you can't, it's going to take 40 years for it to grow back to that size. If you want something different, I think we should try to accommodate that. I mean, it's kind of a thing that we can't not do in the big picture of things, but, that doesn't mean we shouldn't mitigate the pain. To the citizens that are cooperating. That's kind of the way I feel about it. So.
Within the limits that are possible here, I don't think you'd have objection. George?
Mr. Chairman, we could instruct the contractor to get one of the large tree spades and try transplanting them. It's, given the size of the trees, it's been years since I got prices on those. It's probably $500 a tree, maybe $750 a tree or something like that. And we suggested that to the tree warden, but he was fairly confident they wouldn't survive the transplant. But it's something we could try.
You could add that to the list of possibilities that
yes.
would be decided.
The problem is that if it fails,
that's where we're coming back in another year or two before they actually die to replace the trees.
Understand.
You may be better off just picking what you want moving forward.
The branches are that high off the ground, you know, I brush my head on it when I mow the lawn, so.
Doesn't serve as a fence.
You wouldn't get in there with anything and lift them out, not without destroying a lot of the branches that are there.
Tree spade could do it.
Yeah, but you just run the risk of having them back out there again.
Yeah.
You're almost better off saying.
It's your choice, whatever you want. But we're here, you know, we know we're disrupting your properties, we want to put back what you're going to want.
The roadies you can do though, those are at least 10, 15.
Rhododendrons are very high.
Difficult to kill.
Those are difficult to kill. I dragged one out of my front yard and dragged it down my driveway and around into my rear yard and planted a shallow little grave, and the thing's growing better than it was when it was.
I've actually done that same thing. They're hard to kill.
And I cut mine 2 feet in there. They're up to the window.
As long as the soil's reasonable soil, that rhododendrons are going to thrive.
Any other questions from the homeowners? Any public comment? Okay. Close the
hearing. Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the order of taking of water easements at 87 and 93 Belmont Street.
Do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion? 5-0.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the order of taking of water easements at 87 and 93 Belmont Street.
Do I have a second? Marcy seconds again. Any discussion?
I'd just like to clarify that, you know, these guys need to have some latitude in talking with George about, you know, what you guys want back in there.
Appreciate it.
You know.
Yep. Absolutely. Okay. Any other discussion? Here or not? All those in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Have a good evening.
Thanks.
Now what do you want to wait for we'll be in?
Pass it around. We do it now. Is there a special pen you need?
Special pen.
Thank you. Okay. We take a, we're going to sign it. We take a 2-minute break here because you're not going to hear anything else with this thing shuffling across.
First, the legislative by votes to take the parcel, and then it isn't actually effective. So, for the executive body, it's supposed to be order to take.
Got it.
It could be a mayor in a city. It could be a selectman. How you doing, Ron?
Good, how are you?
Good to see you.
Yeah, only because.
subsequently, if you will.
Bob, how'd you want to go through the warrant articles?
Since we previewed the first nine at least previously, unless there's questions, I think we'll just skip over them. Feel free to ask them.
Yeah.
On page 34 of your packet tonight is a new article. Just appeared in the last day. We ran past Tom at town council today, and he's fine with the language. I'm going to turn the discussion largely over to, I know Kevin, one of the residents, has been dealing with it, but the gist of what the change would be, as you can see at the bottom of it, mm-hmm. the current bylaw is to cross that section out. So the words, I think I crossed out the E by mistake there. Nor the rights and privileges of an owner or lessee of land as set forth in Mass General Law Chapter 131 relative to hunting and sporting would be struck in, or stricken rather, from the firearm.
Okay. Is there someone here to speak on behalf of the article tonight? Why don't you stand and introduce yourself? And
I'm Dorothy Marshall.
I'm Walter Marshall.
88 Timberneck Drive in Reading. And
we've got Timberneck Swamp.
Mm-hmm. And okay, a little background. Timberneck Swamp, about 10 years ago, the town decided that because it was so heavily populated area, that they outlawed bow hunting in Timberneck Swamp. And we were under the impression that that was so until I found out that for many years now, there's a private parcel within Timberneck Swamp where people, that's privately owned, where people do bow hunting.
With the permission of the homeowner,
but
the property owner.
When I looked into it further at our bylaws, I realized that the current bylaw says that it's perfectly legal to hunt on private land.
Yep.
And this is obviously a public safety issue. If that area was too dangerous to use bow hunting 10 years ago, we say that, you know, someone shouldn't be shooting a firearm near, you know, this close to our property.
Has there been any instance of firearm discharge?
I have. We've reported to the police. We don't know that it's coming from that area, but the shots come at nighttime in the dark during the winter, and we've reported only a couple times, although it's been going on for years. And I think we probably determined by talking with the police that it's probably someone trapping.
Mm. Or could be someone trapping.
Could be someone
and
trapping,
they
and they
the
shoot
animal.
The animal when they have it caged because they can't transport it. So that's illegal in itself, and that's probably on public property, but. We have heard shots over the years, and we've only called police a couple of times because it seems futile, because it's dark, it's one shot, you know, it's in the middle of a swamp.
So we would just like the language in the, I guess now, with the property owner's permission, you can discharge a gun in this.
And doesn't need Selectmen's approval. And everyone I talked to in town thought it wasn't so. Everyone in town told me, from the police to the Selectmen to the town manager, that you needed Selectmen approval, and you do not. If you read the bylaw, the last
right.
sentence excludes that.
So that's all we're asking for, is to have that deleted from the that a property owner.
I wanted to see it done before hunting season, because hunting season starts October 20th, I think.
Yeah, well, maybe a
so that's why I started in yeah. July.
Mm-hmm. Now we did go to neighbors this morning.
To collect signatures,
we
yeah.
We collected some signatures to just
in
to
case
say
this
that
didn't get on the warrant.
But abutters support,
yeah.
you know,
everyone's
the fact
involved.
That we
yep.
would
any
want to have
town
some
meeting members in your neighborhood? I used to. Do you have any town meeting members that could present
yeah.
the signatures at
yeah.
the town meeting?
Mr. Cohen. Howard,
mm-hmm.
Howard
okay.
Cohen
yep.
is in our neighborhood.
And is Mr. Rickley
is
still
Mr. Rickley on town
yeah,
meeting?
Yeah, he is.
Yeah,
I think he is.
I don't know if he still is.
He may have retired.
Yeah. When was the last
Rickley?
Time you heard
I'm sorry?
Tony Rickley?
Yes.
I don't think he's on town meeting
yeah,
anymore.
There was a gentleman named Watson also. I'm not sure if he's still on there. Garrett's dad.
What was the last time you what was the date of the last time you heard a discharge of the month?
We reported it, I think. It might have been in March.
Yeah. When we met with there were six or eight policemen, enforcement people, environmental people, came to our house to talk about the issue. I wasn't quite sure why, but the lieutenant from the Reading Police had a log of the number of phone calls that we had made and indicated that recently we haven't heard the gunshots, and it is
It's usually in the wintertime when there aren't any leaves on the trees, because I always think it's coming from a house. I can see the lights on the house. I always think it's coming from that direction. And I suggested it might be Pittman, and the officer suggested it might be Libyat.
Is that Timbernick Swamp on the screen?
Yeah. Yep.
So it's that area,
yep.
That green area is privately owned.
Okay.
And our house is right
where our 88 is on there.
Yeah. Right next to the empty lot, right there.
As we understand the law, again, the property owner can give someone permission to shoot on that piece of property as long as he's 500 to, there's a distance he's supposed to be from a structure.
150 from a street.
From a structure. And he may well be within that regulation, but the bullet can travel so far. We just think it's ludicrous that someone can shoot a gun from.
And most people in town thought that it was
illegal. You couldn't discharge
a firearm.
Department,
everyone said, no, you can't discharge a firearm. We said, yes, you can. It says in the bylaw.
So that's all we're asking for is an opportunity to have that.
It seems to be an oversight. It was a law that was, I mean, a bylaw that was written in the 50s before the neighborhoods were there.
So is the problem a universal problem in all of the lands that, you know, around Reading, or is it a problem here?
I'm told that there are only two private parcels this would pertain to.
The private parcel, I guess, has to be 150 to 200 feet from the structure. I'm not sure how it's read,
yeah.
But, you know,
this is
kind of a loophole. This is kind of a, we're not disputing that green shaded area isn't, you know, 500 feet from the structure. However, a bullet can carry a couple of miles inside. And
within that area, they've marked it off where it can be, you know.
That's true, too.
It's a little white
yeah.
area in
right.
there.
The
it's about half the size of that, where someone can stand and actually hunt with a bow and arrow, even, so. I actually have a picture of it here somewhere.
Bob, have there been any, what's the data from Reading PD in terms of?
They've been out and investigated a couple of times and they complain and they don't find anything.
Again, but we do, you know, just so it gets logged and so forth, and it's a concern.
And we've only done it twice, but it's happened many times over the years because it's ridiculous to even call because they're not going to find anyone. It's pitch black, it's a swamp, it's, you know.
But at the same time,
it's one shot.
The lieutenant did encourage us to continue
yeah.
if we heard. Because who knows, they could get lucky sometime and find it. We're not saying that we're not calling because they don't respond or they're not sensitive to our needs.
Right.
We're saying we just don't.
It's just impossible.
We think it's a goose chase.
Yeah.
You have no damage? There's no.
No damage, no evidence, no. We've never seen anyone.
There's no bullet holes in the wall, there's
no
arrows in the side of the house.
No.
And we can hear clearly on a Sunday the. Shooting range that's behind the, so we have a sense of what, that's what one of the policemen said. How do you know it's sort of a lawnmower backfiring or something like that? And I'm not into guns or arms or anything, but it does sound like the report of a gun to me, but.
Yeah, and it's not coming from, we've been there 12 years, we're well aware of the direction from the shooting range. We know what that
right.
sounds
yeah.
like.
Right, yeah, it's not coming from the shooting range at midnight, Sunday afternoons is the
yeah.
attempt.
Not a lawnmower
either.
Right.
So.
And even mows at night, though. Is it possible it's fireworks? You know, some
yes, it could be anything, but it's just one, usually
no,
fireworks.
It's deep,
and,
it's
no. Yeah, and there's a gentleman on, I'd say a gentleman, there's a family that is into fireworks on the next street over in the summertime, so we have
he goes all year round, too.
Well, we have an idea what fireworks are, but I wouldn't say it was fireworks.
So you're
it's one shot, and it's coming from... I can tell you the direction of the swamp where it was coming from.
Where are you implying that it's coming from?
It's coming from here?
Yeah, that in that.
No, I think it's, well, see what the land is. We
is that a house, the yellow? Is that 88?
That's our yellow. See
that's
what
yours
that,
right there.
See where that arm, that thing on the other side that's pointing to the land?
This
I
thing?
Think it's Libby, down there. No.
Why don't you go up on that?
South.
You can actually here, use the mouse.
You can hold.
My house is here. It
yep.
sounds like it's coming this direction, so
oh,
they decided
dear.
That must be Libby. I thought it might be Pittman.
Yeah, that's
Libby.
But that's not the protected area.
You're right.
No,
yeah.
no. Well, it's the direction it's
I'm
coming
saying
from.
It's coming
he could
from
be
this direction, it seems to me. I don't think it's coming from over here. Maybe it could, I guess it could be coming from here.
We don't expect a change in the language to necessarily end the problem. We're concerned that it is legal to discharge a gun in Reading with the permission of the property owner, and that's what we're trying to.
It's a public safety issue,
yeah,
and I would think the town would do that anyway.
Embrace
just
that, yeah, without too much thought.
It's a liability.
But I hear you saying two things. I hear you saying you're concerned about the shot. It's coming from Libby Ave. But the concern is a general concern about discharge of weapons in private property.
We don't think we can do anything about the shot. We're taking it one step at a time, and it's not an anti-hunting issue. It's an anti, don't give someone permission to discharge a firearm on any, not just that triangle, not just that parallelogram, not to be able to give someone permission to discharge a gun in Reading, except for a police officer or a
What are the other places in town that we're going to, if we pass this, if we forward this change with our endorsement as a warrant, what are the other places in town besides this spot that we're changing the law?
Yeah, there's one question. Other parcel, private parcel, that fits, I think, into...
Where is that?
Do you remember where that is?
They didn't know. The police officer just seemed to, he says, I think there might be one other. I'm not even
aware
of
where it is. Yeah, I think the thought was there's two parcels of land that private land.
I get where that, I mean, look, where that is and where all those houses are, if somebody was discharging
travel 2 or 3 miles.
Well, yeah, I mean, now theoretically, you could only hunt with a shotgun or a ball.
A rifle.
Okay. No.
Why?
Because you can't.
There's rifle season, there's shotgun season,
there are limitations around the rifles. I mean, so in other words, the kind of gun you're talking about that will travel 2 miles, it's not a gun that they could legally shoot anyway.
Well, actually, I have a chart that shows that.
It may be, the physics may say it goes that far. What John is saying, it's not permitted, a .308.
That's like a sniper's rifle.
I mean, I get that there are guns that will go that far.
Maximum projectile range of a rifle.
Yeah.
One goes up to almost a mile. There are others that go up to...
What are those rifles? And those are not rifles you can use to hunt in Massachusetts.
Shooters.
I don't know. 22 short is the low. Then they go up to 300 SAB. That goes up to 2.5 miles.
Yeah.
But he's saying...
You can't use those to hunt in Massachusetts legally is what I'm saying.
You can't use that to hunt.
You know, in Massachusetts... I mean, this is not Utah. So, mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. but, so you can't use those kinds of rifles.
Right.
And I'm not disputing the public safety issue with you at all.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
I get that. And you know what? As close as those houses are, you know, a pistol shot, the right kind of shotgun could reach a home. I understand that.
Yep.
And I do understand a public safety issue on that parcel. I'm questioning as we change... a law, you know, what are the unintended consequences of that?
How does Reading apply?
I mean, I don't have any problem with isolating this and saying, let's not do it here.
Why wouldn't it be in everyone's best interest not to be able to shoot a gun, a private citizen, not to have a handgun, and have my permission, if I own, you have my permission to shoot the gun? I just don't think they should. I guess it is becoming
a gun thing
for me, but.
Well, okay, and you know, you're certainly entitled to that opinion, but. You know, a person's not allowed to, you know, pull their gun out and just shoot.
Well, hunting. Okay. For hunting purposes.
Okay.
Is that what it says? For hunting purposes with permission?
This excludes it.
I mean, where I live, I couldn't hunt the squirrels in the backyard because I'm too close to everything.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
Okay, so I'm enjoined from doing that, which is, I should be.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I get that. That's mm-hmm. a safety issue. And now what I'm saying here is, I recognize that happenstantially, where that private piece of property happens to be, even though it's surrounded by conservation land, it's really too close to all those homes shooting anything. I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
And it is conservation land, so it's not marked. People can be walking through there. It's not marked.
my point.
It's private?
Yeah. It's not like, you know, caution, stay out.
My question in approaching it this way, this is a form over substance question for me.
Okay.
Okay. I mean, I don't have any problem with saying that piece of land needs to be enjoined in this way. I have no problem with that, given it's where it is and its proximity to the homes and all that. And
but it's
I do
targeted.
Agree it's public safety.
It's targeted to that area. No pun intended.
Yes.
Well,
I'm just trying to get it right.
Right.
So that there's not an unintended
consequence. Yeah, from what we were told, I don't know off the top of my head the second parcel. We were told there's no more than two parcels of land that would be affected by this.
And again, that was just, I think I told you that because that's what the police officer told me. He thought there might be another one.
The real answer to this is to ask our GIS coordinator, who has not police officers don't necessarily know all the.
Right.
Each of them know an individual neighborhood story, but they don't know a whole collective town picture.
I understand your problem, and I don't disagree that it's something we need to do something about from a public safety standpoint. I just don't want to throw a blanket over the whole town and say, you know, and have an unintended consequence that we have to then go back and fix a different way. I'd rather fix the one that's in front of us, because you feel unsafe, and I get that. I do agree with you that who's ever doing this is probably not going to stop.
Right.
That's my guess. My guess is you're gonna, you know, it may not even be on that private piece.
That's
of land
right.
That this
That's
is
right.
Going on.
But sure. But we felt it. In,
it's a first step. Yeah.
Right.
I get you.
Right.
Marcy.
Yes. So what I would say is I hear what you're saying, but what I think is it gives us the ability as the Board of Selectmen to give written permission, and so any unintended consequences can be easily remedied by somebody coming before the board, and the Selectmen saying, that's okay, you have our permission. So I'm not seeing a big downside in arguing through this necessarily.
Yeah. Any other comments from the board? Bob?
Just a comment to make sure the residents know, and I know this, the horse is kind of out of the barn, but this process would go to November 10th town meeting, which will last approximately 10 days. Then the Attorney General has to, not 10 consecutive days, then the Attorney General has to approve any change, so the October hunting season is long, so
I know it.
By the time this takes.
I know, I didn't realize that
this
one.
This will be probably January.
It just, if I can put in a plug for anybody who's listening at home, if you don't want it to last 10 days, please look at the zoning bylaws.
But isn't there something we can do to expedite it?
No, there's November town meeting. That's
well, we could have a special town meeting.
We're having one in September already, next Monday night.
I wish I'd known that. See, I've been
these
doing this since July.
Yeah.
I've been talking to you since July.
Legally, these things take 2 to 3 months in advance to plan. And
July.
Get to legal.
Yeah, that's when I started, July 14th.
Yeah.
I wanted to have it done by hunting season.
There's no way that's going to happen at this point.
So what's going to happen now? Are we?
Well, yeah.
We need to finish discussion at the board level.
Okay.
So we're just kind of going.
We're
going to
close the warrant. We're not doing that tonight. We're going to just close
Correct.
The warrant.
Correct. Yeah.
The other thing I would mention is this is not uncommon for our area. Turk, did you look up to find out if all of our budding towns,
all
I know, and then some others outside
yeah,
of that,
I have that
range as well, have, I'm not sure, or certainly word for word, in their bylaws, rules and regs, but their discharge of firearms for any purpose other than what's explained in here, obviously. Police, personal harm, whatever it may be, is not allowed. So this isn't something that, from the area standpoint either, that we're breaking ground on. We're actually behind the trend.
Exactly. Stoneham, Wakefield, Wilmington, Woburn, North Reading, Linfield, town with ordinances prohibiting the discharge of firearms.
What's the penalty for violation of this clause? How would the penalty be assessed? No, Chief's not here tonight.
I assume it's the same penalty as any violating any bylaw, which is up to a maximum period of
okay. Unless state statute provides
right.
Otherwise.
I guess from my vantage point, I'd like to see the GIS map just to see where they get the full assessment so we understand what the change would imply to the other.
I don't think that'll slow down getting it.
I don't think it'll have any material effect.
I mean, you know.
Well, there's a couple of choices before us. We can take it off the warrant, put it on future warrant, we can go ahead with this and then vote our position later.
My guess is I'd take it under advisement, would consider it for a future town meeting once we've got the GIS input.
In other words, remove it from tonight's?
Simply because I'd like to hear from Chief and I'd also like to hear from the GIS coordinator in terms of the other parcel.
So you don't feel comfortable in the fact that we have the ability to control this by just somebody comes in and you say, yes, okay, you can do it. I don't see the benefit in delaying, quite frankly.
Yeah, but the board still has the right to unchange it.
I understand. It's always had the right. My point is, let's understand that the three.
Well, they don't have the right, actually, in this case. We don't have the right
to
tell somebody no right now.
But it's not even, I get the point.
Okay.
Let's look at where else this would apply. The discussion tonight has been, it may not even be this parcel, but this change would affect this parcel and potentially one other. I just want to see the other part.
I think, Marcy, you're on something.
I just don't think it makes sense.
If you read this carefully,
Selectman,
at the moment, right now,
right.
This is saying that The written consent of the owner or legal occupant thereof.
And
the written permission of the Board of Selectmen or its designee. So, at the moment...
Except that the last thing that's proposed to be stricken supersedes that.
Right.
You can't stop it there because it's listed as an exception.
Right.
If they struck it as they wish, it's no longer an exception, and then it does...
And now it has to fall under us for approval. Right now, it doesn't fall under...
By striking it, you have the authority to step in and issue written permission or not. Right now, you have no authority.
And again, it's in relation to hunting and sport.
Relief is, I think, come to us, the private owner.
The relief is the private owner would come to us.
And now they don't have to come to us. But why does the ordinance even say that?
They don't have to come to us as long as it's under the guise of hunting.
Great question.
So, I mean, I'm seeing this ordinance saying two things. You know, one is that currently, you know, an owner or legal occupant can give written consent and the written permission of the Board of Selectmen or its designee.
However, the bylaw shall not apply, and that lists a whole lot of exceptions.
And
that,
right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So everything that thereafter is allowable.
Accepted. So you don't have to go to the selectmen to get permission.
I saw.
So that's no longer a reason to be exempt.
That will no longer be the
process. Well,
we could put it to a vote as to how to proceed here if there's doubt on the board.
I don't think the time, I understand the urgency of the applicant. I'm more interested in getting it right than getting it fast, because you get...
I think that they can go hand in hand, because when do we need to have a warrant for the November town meeting?
Tonight.
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 Is it?
Tonight.
You're holding
that's
it.
The point. That's the point, John.
The only choice you have is
either it's here or it's
January.
Not.
Leave it on like
then
that?
Then it
so it'll be January.
Take it off.
January
would be the next one.
I might.
Bob.
The options as I see it is you close it with the song, have some sort of due diligence process between now and November town meeting, and you may decide to table it. If you don't like the result of whatever you find, you can table it. You have that right. You're the sponsor of the article. Or you can go forward with it. Mm-hmm. Or if you're not comfortable, as a practical matter, it's not bad this year since we're having a January 5th town meeting, it's a 2-month delay. Instead of getting the final answer in January, it'd be early March. It's 2 more months, it's not ideal, but as a practical matter, it's not waiting 6 months or a
right.
year.
Right.
So
well, it's not another hunting season.
It seems to me you're worrying about possibly inconveniencing one homeowner while you're jeopardizing the well-being
it's not just
of
one homeowner.
Everyone else
no,
in town.
No, absolutely.
It applies to all private property in Reading.
We don't know if there's, you know, again, someone said there might be one other landowner.
I understand this
I
one
don't
other.
Know.
That's the
applies
point.
To everybody.
Yeah. No, there might be one
well,
other exempt property.
Be able to have hunting or sporting activities
right.
on the land. And that's where it's limited. You can't just do that most
yeah,
of the time.
I mean, you can't do that at my house because we're too close to everybody and there's, you know.
Right. Can't do it in town forests.
I mean, this is
yeah,
the
you know, there's not, there's,
in the
right.
middle of nothing.
There's very, very
yeah.
few spaces
right.
you can
land.
Do it in.
Yeah, and at one time that was the middle of nowhere,
mm-hmm.
and now there's houses
right.
there. So
mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm,
I get it.
I'm
I get
on
it.
Board with you around
mm-hmm.
the public
mm-hmm.
safety issue, 100%. I just don't like raining on somebody else's parade.
Yeah, but
you
if
know?
It's a public, excuse me, if it's a public safety issue here, it's a public safety on his parade too.
Maybe.
So
maybe
well,
that's
I,
the.
Where is it?
Where is it? That's the point.
Where is what?
Where's the other space?
There might not even be another space. Again,
you're right.
Someone
there
just
might not
mentioned.
Be.
Oh, I think there might be one other space and.
I understand the urgency. Please don't mistake the board's due diligence for reluctance to undertake the question. We represent the entire citizenry, and all
right.
we're trying to do is the due diligence. To your own comments tonight, there's been no evidence. There's been no destruction. It's the sound reports, as represented by yourselves, don't necessarily even come from the parcel. It might even not even have any impact on what's going on in Libby Ave,
mm-hmm.
which is
mm-hmm.
where it's reported. So I don't see any particular downside to getting the other inputs. This can be on the January ballot.
Right.
Again, I brought this to the attention of the town manager, the Board of Selectmen, and the police department in July, so I could have this done by the time hunting season started. I have done everything I could do to make that happen. And then I found out yesterday that it was too late, and I was just told to wait, we'll get it on, wait, we'll do this. So here I am today, trying to get it on for November, when I thought this would be done by hunting season.
I understand.
We didn't have a town meeting before hunting season.
I first laid eyes on this, as probably many of the other boards, in its current form, in the package that came out Thursday.
Well, no one seems able to read the bylaw. People kept misreading it, saying, no, they're doing, everything's legal, and I said, read the last sentence, read, I have to illustrate that to everybody.
Okay, again, don't mistake the board's deliberateness for a reluctance to listen to your position. It's more the due diligence aspect of it, and the fact that tonight is the go-no-go decision. Bob?
I just want to make sure that it's very clear for the record that you did report it in July.
Yes.
That it was passed along to the police because you'd heard shots, and that they've investigated quite extensively.
Yes.
So there was no discussion about July about, let's get an article on town meeting.
Right.
There's someone out here
shooting. I was talking to Kevin. I've been talking to Kevin since July.
But there's some evidence there's some reports that's been shooting. It's dangerous in the neighborhood, and it's not that the police did nothing since July.
Oh, we never said that. We never implied that.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. The bigger issue for us is the fact that someone with permission can shoot a gun in, actually, anywhere in Reading. And again...
Well, that's not true.
That's not true.
That's not true.
It says right here that with the written
permission... When they all came to our house, I said, I don't know why you're here, because I just want to change the bylaw. And that's what... And you were on the phone, and you said, I will work with you, and that was July.
That meeting was actually...
That was August.
You have to understand, we have two town meetings a year, one in April, one in November. This has to go to town meeting. So mm-hmm. What you asked for was impossible anyway, without a special having been scheduled.
Well, if you decline me now, do I go and get 200 signatures to have a special
town
meeting?
No, we would put it on for you.
This is just a question of the getting on the schedule for the January town meeting.
I want the November town meeting.
I understand, but there's a due process and there's a warrant review, and I understand your frustration, but we've got a responsibility as well, and that's to make sure we can answer to all the citizens when they ask a question, why'd you do this? And what about the other impacts?
Well, why didn't you do this when someone gets injured? You've known about this since July. Why didn't you do something about this when someone brought it to your attention?
Can I make a motion, Mr. Chairman?
Dan, go ahead.
I'd like to move to amend the prior motion to consisting of 9 articles and also to strike Article 10 from the November 10th town warrant. I'm moving to close the warrant with the first 9 articles and not the 10th article. So it would affect the motion I just made, changing 10 to 9, and strike Article 10.
Yeah.
And that would be an amendment to what I did.
Okay. Again, before we take a vote on the amendment, I just want the applicants to understand this doesn't speak to the merits or the urgency or your interest. It's merely that we represent all the members of Reading, all the citizens of Reading, and I think you'd be remiss in not understanding if there are other groups that are impacted. The practical side of this is that for all but one or two locations, this is already prohibited. And even by your dialogue tonight, this isn't even present there. It's a problem you've identified. It's a real problem. But the circumstances you've described don't arise from this location.
I don't know that they do.
You haven't said anything that says otherwise, and in fact, you've pointed at Libby Ave. And
That's where I hear them at nighttime. I have no idea about that other parcel. But
I understand.
But I have collected signatures from today. In the event that this didn't make the warrant, I've collected signatures in the neighborhood, and everyone's pretty much appalled.
I understand, but. Listen, the outcome of tonight will determine only whether it's in November or January. We'll determine the...
You say you're just to put this on as a petition article?
We don't know.
10 signatures. You could have put this on 10 signatures.
Oh, no, I didn't get 10. I stopped.
No, I mean, do you have the verbiage of this warrant article on your petition?
No. Yes, on the article I want to change, yes, I do.
So are you petitioning this on to the town meeting? Is that the purpose of the petition?
I guess. We just wanted to get...
Kevin told me it might not be brought up tonight, and I said, well, I have to, get someone's attention, and I will go around and get people's signatures.
So what you're saying, Dan, is that 10 signatures can, a citizen or a town meeting member can put it 10
signatures. They could put this on their own and argue with themselves.
And that would be fine.
That's fine.
And you know what? In fairness to your request, that would give us the opportunity between...
Right.
So if you had 10 signatures on this thing.
Oh, I have, yeah.
Okay, then a town meeting member can.
Sponsor an article.
Can present that article for, at the very, at the special, at the next town meeting in November.
Oh, not September.
No, because that's been closed now for a long time. But the point is that I think that you could, I think that may be a good compromise for all parties, is that it sounds like, Dan, correct me if I'm wrong, because you really are resident parliamentarian. 10 signatures on a petition that contains this language would allow that to run, be presented at town meeting.
It would just say by petition instead of the Board of Selectmen.
Okay, so now you get it on, so it goes there. That gives us the time between now and then to get the information that satisfies us, and we can stand up, you know, and on behalf of this. So this is not about, please, this is not about being attentive to your, to the public safety issue you've raised. I mean, I get that. If there was a way for us to name this property in this, I'd be fine doing it tonight, but I don't think there is.
1 minute.
Sorry, 1 minute, please, Bob.
I'm not a lawyer, but this won't fly as a citizen's petition because all it does is state the bylaw and what the problem is. It doesn't state any kind of remedy to the bylaw or change to the bylaw.
But that
so
should be.
It lists the bylaw, some of the words.
Yeah,
read,
it would
some
have
underlined.
To be. This but
yeah, but that would be easy to correct.
No.
No, I don't think
this
so.
Is what
to,
goes
have
on.
To have
you have to have the signatures.
Right
motion
on.
Can be under this. But.
What I'm saying is. You know,
you can't correct
this
primary.
Lady has said to says she's ready to go get 200 signatures for a special town meeting.
Except
so rewriting a petition that gets 10 signatures on it doesn't sound like heavy lifting.
No,
is it 10 or 100?
So Bob's suggestion was go ahead and vote it and then we can table it later.
Maybe
if you do the research and discover that this you don't want to support it, you can table it later and then it could come up for later. I personally don't I understand what you're saying about wanting to do due process, but quite frankly, we're going through a lot of gyrations for something that we already have the control over. I think it should go forward. It doesn't make sense to me to pull it off. Unless we go through and do more due diligence and then we say we're going to table it because we've seen a reason now why.
Yeah, just to speak on that, this was a, I can appreciate, you know, looking at it from, it's a very fast process that we're putting this one under. That being said, as Marcy's saying, we still have plenty of time to look at. It's still something that you can still do your due diligence and yet not have it in November. So it doesn't really, the position right now, the way I see it, you have one or two options. You can go ahead and vote this down and do the due diligence, find out that it does look like a good thing to sponsor or the marshals can actually get a petition worded the way they want it and put it on for January. Or we can go ahead tonight and put it on for November. And then if, upon doing your due diligence, even get public input in the meantime, if so choose to be, you could decide to table it at that point if you feel like it's nothing that you wanted to sponsor. It wasn't what you signed up for, so to speak. There's no real harm because you can still do what you're speaking of, and we can still do it for the marshals, which is get it on at the earliest next town meeting.
Any other comments from the board?
The only problem I have with that statement is that having Board of Selectmen on the article implies endorsement. You know, prima facie implies
but if,
endorsement.
But again, if it's something you'd like to endorse, then it's something that we're not
on
the table.
Why would we put
but
something on that we're not prepared to endorse?
Excuse me. I was going to say, my understanding, Bob, at least this is what happened in the past, is if you have two votes, it's on the town warrant. It doesn't have to be a majority. So it doesn't necessarily imply that the Board of Selectmen supports it. You just need two votes in favor.
Actually, she's
to get
absolutely
it on
correct.
That's right. So
we have two.
And the other part of it is too, as Dorothy has said, it was supposed that there may be one other location. We don't know that. Correct. So tonight, the information we have is we know there's one location. We don't know if there's a second.
I'm going to withdraw my amendment with the permission of the secretary. Let this go forward.
All right. Any other discussion?
Can I clarify one point before?
Sure.
And that is that the focus, the scope of this was not to stop. I know it's not trying to stop the gunshots. I think it's absurd that a private property owner can give someone permission to shoot a gun in Reading, anywhere in this town. I don't care if it's 1,000 feet from a house or a roadway or anything. it's too congested, there's too, my, when our kids were young, my kids would go out in that swamp and stuff like that. And I just think it's absurd. That's where I'm coming from. Might be a little bit different from what Dorothy's saying, but I just don't see how a private property owner can say, here, take this gun, it's okay to shoot it. And I think that's where I'm coming from. I know it's not gonna stop the shot in the middle of the night or whatever we're hearing. I'm not looking for enforcement, I'm looking to change. I think it's absurd that that's written the way it is.
And again, all the abutters have outlawed the discharge of firearms, all the abutting towns.
Right, yeah.
Reading is by itself.
We're not a trendsetter here.
Marson?
Thank you.
Ready for the vote?
Yeah. All those in favor of the, closing the warrant consisting of, I guess now, 10 articles?
Still 10.
Raise your hand.
We're closing it?
That was a yeses?
It's a yes, 5-0.
Is that a yes? I need to back up then, because I need to abstain for lack of information.
All right.
So I need to have my vote registered as, you know, not for or against, but in light of this recent addition, I need to abstain for lack of information on being able to make a vote.
The vote here just puts it on the right. Warrant. Right. It doesn't.
My point is that, you know, from my perspective, I'm abstaining because I feel like I need more information to be able to vote it on. Yep. That's just my opinion.
Does that make him abstain from the all?
You only need two selectmen votes to get it on.
No, I know. I'm just thinking for John's benefit. I think you're abstaining from all 10 articles, not just
the warrant. That's the only way I can do it.
There's only one warrant.
Okay. No, I just want to.
All you're doing is closing the warrant.
Right.
At a future meeting, the selectmen will be asked to vote on
individual.
Each individual.
That's a whole separate
discussion. That's the only thing I was bringing up for you.
That's fine.
Okay.
I'm happy to be registered the way I'm registered.
Close the warrant.
For the reason
I'm, you
know.
Majority.
And I want to clarify to you that I do understand the safety concern and endorse the idea of enjoining anything there. I just, I'm a guy that doesn't really embrace unintended consequences of regulations.
Mm-hmm.
I like, it's just, it's who I am, and I'm not going to change that. Okay, so.
Points well taken. That's fine.
Thank you.
So what do we do, or
well, hang
what
on.
Does this
I just
mean?
Want to clarify, John, we took a vote, it was 5-0. Are you asking to?
I
didn't raise his hand. Change. You didn't ask for zeros.
You did, it was 5.
No. Oh, you raised your hand?
I didn't realize. I'm what I'm saying to you is that I misunderstood what I was voting on.
Okay. Let me read. All those in favor of the motion to close the warrant consisting of 10 articles for the 2014 subsequent town meeting, raise your hand. All those against, all those that abstain, raise your hand.
There you go.
Okay, so it's 3-0-1.
Okay.
0-2.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
I have a question on the state warrant, page 37.
Yeah.
I don't know if this is a typo, Bob. The title says state primary warrant. Should it say state election warrant?
That's a good question. I don't know. It comes right from the town clerk's office.
Uh-oh. I don't think that's right.
I don't think she mics this form up.
Actually, she did because
she
hadn't gotten the
police. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I suggest you amend by striking the word primary and just leave it a state warrant.
State election warrant, I think it would have to be.
Yeah, election.
Also, should the motion reference the date of the election instead of just saying the 2014 November?
We had a problem before where the date wasn't listed, and then we had to go back
was,
and get a special.
That was in the town meeting warrant.
Mm-hmm. I think that was a slightly different issue. And this should be the 11-4-2014 state election, I think. That's the technical name of it. Any way to get Ray on the phone, maybe? No need?
That's in the title.
State election
right.
Would be proper.
So,
state election warrant on the title and then
right.
State election.
So I will move that the Board of Selectmen close the warrant as amended, with striking the word primary and adding the word election in the title.
Okay.
For the 11-4-2014 state election.
Okay. Do I have a second? Marcy will second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? 5-0. No zeros and no ones.
No.
All right.
And finally, one more time with feeling. To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold public hearings, a public hearing on September 23rd, 2014, in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Wall Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on the following. Application for waiver of hours of operation for Cumberland Farms, 303 Salem Street, 8:45 p.m. Copies of the proposed documents regarding this topic are available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, Monday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesday from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and are attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on September 23rd, 2014, to town manager at ci.reading.ma.us.
Okay, thank you. Bob?
Thank you for bearing with us.
Yes. This is one of our more exciting evenings. If folks would like to come forward. You don't have any, never mind.
Frisk him.
Mr. Chairman, other members of the board, my name is John Smolak, attorney for Cumberland Farms. With me is Ken Flint, area sales manager, mm-hmm. Cumberland Farms. And as for the sake of brevity, we're simply requesting an expansion of hours of operation from the current hours of operation of 6 a.m. to 11 p.m. to 5 a.m. To 11 p.m. to capture that first hour Monday through Friday as allowed under the regulations. And you're well aware of the site, I assume, 303 Salem Street. Cumberland Farms is operating that site for maybe 25 or 30 years or so. And it's been a gas station since approximately 1955, based on time records. And we simply feel that even today we have cars at Cumberland Farms that are lining up at 6 a.m. Or before 6 a.m.
Before 6.
Parked there waiting for the store to open. And so what we would like to do is capture those earlier commuters and have the ability to have them refuel or pick up something at the store at 5 a.m. during the weekdays. And we feel that by operating for an additional hour that it's not a significant impact to the neighborhood. We feel that with some recent improvements that are going to be, that were improved and are going to be implemented with additional screening and landscaping, we feel that the operations will continue to operate well and without impact to the neighborhood. And okay. So we're respectfully requesting the board's approval of that.
Now, consistent with other the plans into tonight's packet, this is drawn here with the yellow square. The area, the property area is being expanded to include the adjacency on.
Yes, so you should mention the land acquisition.
Yeah, the land.
Yes, that's true. It's
Cumberland.
Yeah, it's 8 Torrey Street.
That's
which
it.
Is,
thank you.
As part of the site and as part of
the little one between.
It's the little slice to the top of it.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Okay. And so that's been combined and actually has been approved by the CPDC as a few set down the deal. And so that's allowing us to provide some additional traffic circulation improvements and some additional parking on the site, while at the same time we're providing much more landscaping on the residential side of the property to the rear of the property.
I have a question.
Sorry, Dan.
Did you have your hand up before?
I did.
Why don't you go ahead?
The one thing I just wanted to confirm is just making sure that there won't be any kind of pickups or drop-offs, no deliveries.
Covered.
Everything will still be during the normal hour, so it will be strictly be right. People coming through the parking.
Trash pickup, same thing?
Same thing.
Yeah, there won't be any change.
Is that additional land for putting a drive-through possibly around the building?
It's in here.
No. That was added to provide additional parking.
It's in the package on Thursday.
The building is far. Setbacks from that particular area, so we never drive-through.
For the board's benefit, current bylaw prohibits opening prior to 6, but we have in the past issued a number of exceptions, a remarkable number of fitness centers opening at 5 in the morning.
And now there are people who need their coffee
and
after they're done.
And
yes.
In fact, right up the street, right next to the former registry in REI, is that I think the closest example of that is a Dunkin' Donuts that occupies the last sliver of that building, that also opens at 5. And to my knowledge, that's not resulted in any adverse reports from the neighbors. They've been cooperating and recognizing that cars shouldn't be idling at that hour and keeping them away from the fence. So there's strong precedent here for this kind of request and response from the board. Bob, did you have your hand up?
I just wanted to make sure that, just for the record, CPDC issued a site plan review, and that still is fully enforced. So that's what dictates hours of trash pickup and such. Mm-hmm. All you're giving them is permission for retail sales.
Okay. I think the same thing with the relocation of the trash works, correct?
Yeah, you have no say over it.
Right.
Okay. Any other comments from the board?
The other comment, it might kind of be obvious, but this has been a business in town that's been a pleasure to work with the staff. I know when you did your renovations down there, staff was very impressed at how fast you did it, even though you dropped a pipe on one of their feet. but they were really impressed at the end product and how nice it looked and how easy you were to work with. So I just wanted to make sure you knew that.
And for the record, your gas prices rock.
Thank you very much.
And good luck over in Wakefield.
Yeah, I understand you have a sister organization over there. So, any other comments from the board? If not, any public comment?
What are the...
Why don't you introduce yourself for those?
Ron O'Keefe, Precinct 1. What other businesses that serve food opens at that time? Is in Reading.
Yeah.
I can give you a list. There's the JK's Market, Starbucks, they're open at 5:45. A couple of Starbucks at 5 and Dunkin' Donuts at 5 a.m. Those are the food establishments. Plus the Reading Shell Station on Walker's Brook also now has a Dunkin' Donuts component, and they're 24 hours.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's generally done like, Ron, for the convenience of the public or the enhancement of public safety.
What about the employees that don't want to go to work? They'd have to be to work at 4 o'clock in the morning.
I'm not sure. I think that's outside of the purview of this board to render an opinion on. Any other public comment? Sir? Just introduce yourself.
Pat Driscoll, Seven Line Road. I really think this is more of a question of what type of community we want, what we want in terms of neighbors, what you would want as a neighbor. The added noise that's going to happen in the morning. Like they said, people are there already lining up. What's going to stop them from lining up at 4:30 in the morning? I can't have my window open in the middle of the summer night because there's doors slamming. Same thing in the morning. To me, this is a question about being a good neighbor. You say that you're making changes in terms of the landscape. What I have in my backyard, I can't see you. That's going to change because of the changes that were already approved, which is going to add more traffic closer to my house, more lights to my house. This is in terms of gas stations. You're talking Dunkin' Donuts. We're talking filling gas at that hour. To your point, employees getting there earlier. Again, noise. I mean, 11 to 4, that's your sleeping hours. I don't think that's fair. I think the only one really benefiting from this is Cumberland Farms.
Bob, could you show us where Mr. Driscoll's
house? I was about to say the same thing.
Which address?
Seven Line Road.
Around here somewhere.
So, wow.
I guess.
You know.
I just want to make sure the board knows and everyone in the room knows. If approved tonight, this permission runs out at December 31st. Mm-hmm. And well in advance of that, in November, the board will be asked to reconsider all early opening permits. So effectively, if they give permission tonight, this is from now through the end of November, just so you know that. So there's a test period kind of available, if you will. This isn't permission forever. It has to be renewed annually. And just from, not this exact circumstance, but all circumstances with its exceptions, there's a renewal process. And anytime there's been any reports of anything that has happened to the adverse impact of the neighborhood, the board takes that into serious consideration. So the fear of it is justifiable and certainly valid. But if there's actual reports of, you know, earlier trash pickups or whatever the situation might be, that's where the board in the past has considered not giving out that permission.
Now, Well, and all due respect, I don't think it's about the trash pickup. I think it's the traffic.
Yeah.
I mean, why do they want to open it? Because they know that there's people there. I go there every morning. Their coffee's great. That's great. But that doesn't mean that it needs to be open at an extra hour to obtain that customer. Because the other question you have to ask too is, what type of customer is there at 5 in the morning? It's construction. It's construction trucks. They're there. Right. They're not just there grabbing a coffee and then leaving. They're waiting. It's their meeting area. That's where they meet. They talk. The trucks are on running. There's conversation that goes on. So it's not just that people are coming in and grabbing coffee. They're staying there for a long period of time. And they know that's the problem. That's why they add it on into the parking lot. Because their customers that do come and go can't get in and out of the parking lot.
That's right.
That's the reason why. Because they have these trucks there. It's a main meeting area for companies. And again, I think this is what type of community we want to be. Do we want to open up at 5 in the morning, which requires people to get there earlier? And what type of neighbors are we having?
Bob, do you remember in the case of Dunkin' Donuts, wasn't there a particular requirement that prior to 6 the parking be relocated to some other part of the parking lot?
Yeah, there was a concern about headlights.
Headlights.
Residences. So there was a restriction on a certain area before 6.
In terms of that parcel right there, I believe that, I mean, in terms of if your concern is headlights, which I don't think it is, but there's a fence between the Cumberland Farms site and there's a brook, the Walker's Brook, before we get to your house. And so there is existing screening and landscaping in that particular side.
My point was more of the principle of one might put other restrictions in place for the 5 to 6 hour that deal with some of the point issues that have been raised here tonight.
But you, in terms of lights, you have LED lights, but you also have the lights for the safety of the place, to light the parking lot up, to have the lights on in the store. Those lights, where they're changing the parking lot, will go directly into my bedroom. And where you guys are there taking down, which was approved, stuff that was back there that the conservation committee wants them to take down because they don't want it there. So it's also going to take time for the growth of these things to actually occur too, with the landscape they're putting down.
But there's also a fence being installed to the rear of the site as well as part of what was required through the conservation commission and landscaping. So
how tall is that fence?
So, say at least 6 feet.
And how tall are the street lights?
I don't know offhand.
I know there's very strict regulations in CPDC about the lighting spill, and they go through lots of that stuff.
In tonight's package,
I know that they really stress that.
In tonight's package, it details there'll be what's called a photometric assessment, which is the where the light is incident on the ground, the angle of which it can be seen and not seen from the reflector. It deals with the fact that you see a light coming in your house, and modern day zoning and regulations deals with that very problem of, generally speaking, light pollution.
Light leakage.
Light leakage.
Somebody puts it.
When they do the landscaping, do they test for noise pollution too?
I can't answer that question, but on the specific question of light, the question you're driving at, which is the light is visible from my bedroom, that is a particular point that CPDC's focused on. Any other comments from the board? Okay, any other public comments? Okay, yeah?
Mr. Chairman, move that the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the request for early opening for Cumberland Farms 303 Salem Street.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Marcy seconds. Any discussion? Seeing none. All those in favor, raise your hand. 500.
Let's see. Bob, before I make this motion, the restrictions on the hours of deliveries and garbage pickup, is that implied elsewhere in regular?
It is. It is.
There we go. Move that the Board of Selectmen approve a license to operate a retail business between the hours of midnight and 6 a.m. pursuant to Section 7.1 of the Reading General Bylaw and further pursuant to Section 3.9 of the Board of Selectmen policies to Cumberland Farms, 303 Salem Street, subject to the following conditions. One, this license is for approval pursuant to the Board of Selectmen Regulation 3.9 to open for business not earlier than 5 a.m. on Monday through Friday and not earlier than 6 a.m. on Saturday, Sunday, and holidays. Two, this approval expires at midnight, December 31st, 2014. Three, all signs shall conform to the zoning bylaws of the Town of Reading. In granting this license, the board finds it in accordance with Section...
I'll get two more.
Okay. Thank you. Section 5.10.4 of the general bylaws, that it is in the interest of the public health, safety, and welfare, or the public necessity or convenience will be served by permitting such operation, and there is no detrimental effect to such operation on the town or the immediately abutting neighbors.
Do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Discussion.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to vote against this motion. I'm mindful of that last clause, and what I've heard tonight, Mr. Driscoll suggests that there is already a detrimental effect which may worsen. I think this is the first time such a request has elicited such a comment, and I'm going to be mindful of it.
I understand. It's not the first time the comments of this sort have come before us. What, the way the board has generally attempted to address that is in the manner Bob mentioned earlier, which is to evaluate the condition, minimize it by virtue of conditions, and then evaluate it over the initial period, and then you have actual results rather than the theoretical, and you have a means to maybe make mid-course corrections if something unforeseen comes up that no one could have anticipated.
Fine.
Any other comments? Kevin?
Yeah, just to reiterate what Dan's saying, I actually know exactly where you're coming from, Dan. I certainly appreciate your position. If we didn't have such a short window to kind of test this out, and I know it's going to come at probably not the best of noise for you, you know, well-being, I would tend to agree with Dan, and I'd be against this, but where we do have a time to actually vet this out a little bit in a short period of time, I'm actually going to be for this. That said, that doesn't mean that it's the end of it. If it's deemed to be a problem, certainly on the neighbors in that community, then it's going to be deemed to be a problem.
And we'll hear about it, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I'm sure we'll hear about it. So I think normally I'd be right with you on that, but I think I'm going to be in favor of this.
Just want to send a friendly message to Cumberland with the vote that we want this to work. If this prevails, that you need to make things as good as you can for your neighbors.
Yeah, I mean, we'd like to see everybody. We'd love to see open at 5 and love to see you not be affected by it.
I know, okay, just in the past, okay, when we had had our recent remodel, okay, we had changed. I'm not sure if it's this gentleman or not. Okay, one of the neighbors on Line Street there had asked, okay, that we change the lighting, okay, and we didn't do that, okay, to accommodate that. So we're in it, okay, to be a good neighbor. So
if this article goes forward tonight, when would the earliest be that you'd be in a position with the construction and the other planning for this to come to fruition?
Well, I think the actual construction work is scheduled to start on October 6th.
Right, but this could take effect immediately,
right.
Without the other property being involved.
So do you think you would start the opening early after the construction or before the construction?
That's really the question. Would you open it before or after construction?
Probably can time it after the construction. It'd probably be a little bit easier on the neighborhood and on the noise and whatever it may be and stuff.
So how long will your construction period be?
I believe 3 weeks.
So you're really talking about November.
November 1.
And then you come up for renewal.
2 months.
Right. So you'll have a 3-week trial and then you're up for renewal again.
3 weeks?
Mr. Driscoll.
It's December 31st.
Oh, yeah, you have 2 months.
The trial period that we're going to have here really doesn't exist. I mean, we're going to have a 1 to 3 weeks trial period. Based that their construction is on time, on all that, right?
Not sure I understand what you're saying.
I'm not sure.
Well, you're saying that with, I'm sorry.
Well, no, he's. I think what
you're
saying is
that this is it's only temporary, or could be temporary because it's a trial period till November. They're saying that the early opening might not even start until November.
Yeah. So what will happen is,
but through the end.
I mean, I think what I heard from the gentleman from Cumberland Farms is he knows that the neighborhood will be in a little bit of an uproar from October 6th, probably through the balance of the month. So rather than add any confusion, he said he would start that after the construction was over, which then seems like, you know, you've got about a two-month period of time when the construction is over and the early open is going on, and the renewal of that variance would come up before year's end. So, I mean, that would give you adequate time to, you know, try to work it out as good neighbors and see how it's working.
I just saw Mr. Flint make the offer to actually open early, if that would address your concern, if you actually wanted the full period starting.
Well, I'm just saying, I mean, first of all, the only way, in terms of where I live, which I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, the house that they bought, there's no one there. Next to that is the garden school.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So really, in terms of Reading residents, because the other side of the road is Wakefield, so there's nobody here that's going to speak to that.
That's true.
It's very limited amount of people that actually would be able to be affected enough to actually speak up.
But there are six or seven houses there, right?
There's at least three, four, five houses there on your side of the street, are there not?
Yep.
That number one, number
only really four that are affected.
But they're in terms of where the noise is going to be generated from, and there's just not that many houses to even.
Yeah, there's maybe the top three, right?
Yeah.
You and your neighbors coming in.
Right.
Yeah.
The proposal I think the board is at least considering is if construction starts on the 6th, it completes notionally by the end of October, maybe the first week in October, and then you have a period until the first week in October till whenever this board does renewals, which typically is early in December. So you'd have nominally 3 to 4 weeks. And if you still feel the same way and there can't be some accommodation, we'll certainly entertain it.
I think, going back to the original, I think it's about the type of community we want. And I really ask you to think about this question. How does this benefit the town of Reading? Does it improve, do we have more jobs from it? No, they're gonna have the same employees. They'll only open up an hour early. The only people that benefit from this is Cumberland Farms.
Public too.
There's a public safety aspect to it, to the degree that folks are looking for gasoline or looking for something open at that hour of the day. That's the other consideration. This is not the first time an applicant has come to us and asked us to consider for food or some other commercial purpose to open up early. So I very much understand your concerns. I understand the proximity. I'm very sensitive to it. We're about to take a vote on the subject. There's an opportunity here to do a trial and then, with absolute fact, reconsider the whatever decision's made here tonight.
And I know it feels like, you know, you're saying that there's not a lot of folks affected. Right now, you feel like you're affected when you showed up here tonight, and that affected the board. So it doesn't take a whole lot to make an effect.
That's a good point, Kevin.
You know, the one thing I would say, folks are getting up, going to work a lot earlier, mostly out of necessity. Some out of traffic, they don't want to, you know, they want to get out there before it hits, and this does provide, from what we've been told, a public service to that degree, where those folks don't have to travel a farther distance to get what they're looking for to get going. You know, so, you know, we're not, your words aren't falling on deaf ears, you know.
And we're certainly willing, on behalf of Cumberland Farms, to work with you as well between now and then.
Absolutely. I mean, I know, okay, within the last year, I don't know if it was. Was it you that?
No, I've been just purchased just over a year.
Okay, all right. I know. Okay, one of the neighbors. Okay, one of those first three houses or whatever. Yep. They had requested a trash barrel. Okay, be put out. Okay, right around the corner. Okay, like I said, someone else requested we change the light out. Okay, so we're trying to be as accommodating as we can. Okay,
right.
And
that's good to know.
Yeah, we're really easy to work.
Actually, I have a suggestion, Mr. Driscoll. There's an offer that's been made. Would you be willing to chat with these gentlemen and make that part of the dialogue that you present when you come back?
And again, I think that part of this too is the first that I hear about this is less than a week ago. We're here as neighbors, knock on the door and let us know what you're thinking.
I think it was all published, wasn't it?
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
I mean,
the butters notice went out.
There wasn't a butters notice that went out, correct?
A week ago I got
okay.
An email.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's all, you know.
So the one thought is work with these gentlemen. It sounds like you've caught the ears of the board.
I appreciate that.
So That's the essence of neighborliness, is willing to listen and willing to compromise, so. All right, if there are other comments, all those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. Against? Abstain? Zero. So 4-1-0. Motion passes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we will again listen and reconsider the renewal in the December timeframe. Oh. I thought you were pointing at my screen.
Oh no, I quit.
All right. Are we on the downhill slide now?
All right, I think hopefully we're on the downhill side. We're now yes. Gonna move to amend the Board of Selectmen policy regards agency and license authority for alcohol licensing. So in our packet tonight on Thursday, there was a background that the language of the current bylaw does not presently include the deputy chief. I'm scrambling to try to find the section.
What page are we on?
I think it's in the packet that came over.
If you look at five, I'm sorry, motion 5G, that summarizes it. Let me find the background. 5G2 in your weekend packet. Let me read to you the bylaws or the policy as it stands. 3274, agents of the licensing authority. The licensing authority hereby appoints the chief of police and the police department lieutenants and sergeants as agents such and such and so forth. So there's no list of deputy chief.
Right.
You just need to add that in. Okay. He's not the chief or lieutenant
position,
or sergeant.
Right.
All right, Dan, do you have a motion?
I do. Move that under Selectman's Policy 3.2.7.4 that the licensing authority hereby appoints the deputy chief of police as an additional agent of the licensing authority to ensure that the policies of the licensing authority and the Massachusetts state laws regarding alcoholic beverage licensing are adhered to by all licensees.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. 5-0. Thank you. Next, we have a jump ahead to our agenda here.
The AN
notes.
Our bond anticipation notes.
Yeah, Paul, is what Nancy just rushed in there important? Is that something assigned? Okay.
Oh boy. Okay. And I'm assuming this needs to be read in its entirety?
Yes, why don't you read the motion?
Okay.
Well, we'll cut
you don't have to read it in its entirety.
Okay. Somebody can step in.
Yep.
Move that all action taken by the town treasurer in advertising for public sale of the $1 million bond anticipation notes, the note of the town authorized pursuant to Chapter 44, Section 7 of the Mass General Laws as amended and supplemented and by votes of the town duly adopted be and hereby is ratified, approved, and adopted.
Ms. West moves to suspend with the reading of the motion. Discussion. Bob, do you want to talk to this?
Fairly straightforward. Normally we don't like to borrow short bonds, but when we go over a fiscal year, we're forced to by law. If you rewind back to the spring or even earlier, we thought the West Street project would be half done by now, honestly. And then there was an update in February that said, well, the bids will be in by May now at the latest instead of February.
Just kidding.
So we were stuck at the end of the year and decided, you know, in case the state suddenly surprises us and says the bids have been awarded, and by the way, you owe us so much money, we better have it. So we borrowed with a bond anticipation note over the end of the fiscal year, just in case the state asked. And to be honest, there's been other costs such as easements. You know, we had a couple hundred thousand dollars worth of easements along West Street. So we really had to find a source of funds for that can't bridge over a fiscal year, which is why we did the million. Once you do that, you have to keep doing that until you issue permanent debt, and we're just not in a position yet because we still don't know what our West Street costs are, and we don't know what the final situation is for the library, although that'll be coming up within 30
yep.
days. So this is just an extension of short-term borrowing that the board doesn't see very often. Before I got here, the town used to do it all the time. It's just not really necessary.
late January, early February. We expect to issue permanent debt in the amount of 18 odd million that will cover the permanent share of the library, the West Street project, and some more water main work. We may, subsequent to that, if nothing else changes, I'm sure we will need to do some permanent borrowing for the state share of the library. Because remember, they're paying us over 5 years. The construction is going to be done within 2.5. Mm-hmm. So some of that money will come in well after the project is done. We'll need to have ponied up taxpayer money, if you will, up front, and then they get paid back later on, just like the high school work does.
So Bob, I'd asked by email, but just so I understand, it's the temporary debt that needs to be renewed or refreshed because of the
correct
transition over. It's just the same amount, but it's in a new form.
It had to be done over the fiscal year for the reasons I stated, and now that it matures, I think on the 26th of September, mm-hmm. you can't internally borrow something you've already gone to the public markets on. That's illegal. So we have to then permanently fund it on the 26th of September or temporarily fund it again. Those are only two choices.
Got it.
So we're choosing to temporarily fund it.
It's like a continuing resolution, as it were.
Exactly. Exactly.
Good example. Mm. All right. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. 5-0. All right.
And I'll apologize for all the signing you need to do, but I will warn you that February will be substantially worse.
All right.
Next, we have an approval of change of a DBA for the wine shop.
It's pretty straightforward.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Ensminger?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the change of DBA for Brooks Brew and Fine Wines LLC to the Wine Shop and More.
Very good. Do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Any discussion? If you read your Thursday packet, it's pretty straightforward. It's simply a refresh of the signage. So. Mm-hmm. There are no other questions? All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. 5-0. Okay. And now we move to finalization of the town manager's goals.
So tonight in your packet, there's the summary on page 23. It starts. Many of the selectmen met in individual meetings or small meetings last Tuesday. So they've already had a discussion. Marcy was the one person that was omitted, and you've got a special packet tonight.
I did actually rate them today during the day.
Oh,
they're
okay.
Not significantly different
better
from what other people have rated.
No cheating.
However, I do think there's actually something that's missing. Some of the things that we talked about, like when we had the EBSAT, we talked about actively marketing the town to residents and to businesses, and I actually think that should be incorporated in here in one of these goals. It probably fits in along with something that's in here. The other thing is building positive relationships with businesses and residents, and I think those two things are important things for the town manager to do. And if I had been any better and read it sooner, I would have suggested them sooner. So
what was the second one?
Well, there's actually, you know, if you look at this thing on the last page, I did a couple
right
too, and Bob just
yeah
added them.
Oh.
So there's provision.
We can tuck them in.
For add-ons.
Think
oh,
where
add-ons, yep. I did see that. So I just think it's important to make that part of the core goals is to actively market the town to residents and businesses, because it is important. And we had so many different people who said communication to town is important, and the people on town staff said communication is important. So I think it's a good one.
It absolutely is. John and I talked, John Halsey and I talked a week or so ago, or maybe 2 weeks ago now, about, in addition to the town manager's goals, the overarching strategic goals for Reading 2020 and just Reading in general, and how at the implementation of the EDSAT findings, the outreach to our business community, both current members in town as well as those interested in the town and those not even knowing we exist. Those are really strategic thoughts that the underlying goals need to dovetail with. And so there's at least the very skeletal beginning of a thought to a three-legged stool with a strategic goal, the operational goal, you know, we're doing the right things, doing things right, and then measuring the results are kind of the way I think of it. Where this would dovetail very well. Your comments about adding those here are perfect, because they already exist in the proposed strategic plan that we've penciled together. Bob?
And I agree with everything you've said. The format that you showed me, I think it was a week ago, with John's help, I thought was excellent.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah, the embedding of the numbers and the tables.
And I sat in front of both documents for three different times, trying to figure out, how do I put this into that? And you covered, I don't know, pick a number, two-thirds of the town manager's goals in that other document.
Right.
But the other third didn't naturally fit anywhere that I could think of, so something's missing.
They're tactical, not strategic.
And I was wondering if that's what it fell to, that they weren't long-term.
I saw that.
Okay.
When I, after that meeting,
Okay.
I was looking to see if, you know, I mean, John actually took a conversation he and I had and
Yep.
did a beautiful job
He did.
Of putting it into, you know, kind of three major areas. And I wanted to see what we missed.
Can you throw that up, Bob? Do you have a means to do that on the
I don't think
I
have.
And I think what it was, John, is I, you know, you did not address as many tactical issues as Bob addressed in his goals.
Correct.
Which makes sense. It's a strategic right. plan.
Well, in the way it was structured was there's a goal, there's a series of activities that support the goal, and then the activity has a series of, I use the term focused means. What are the vehicles by which that activity will be conducted? The tactics are those focused means. By executing the tactic, it supports the activity, which is part of the larger strategic plan.
But yeah, you're right, John, but what Bob built in this document here are some things that he feels we need to
Absolutely.
Have us look at that Absolutely. Are kind of, they're connected to the scope of 2020, but they're not necessarily,
right.
you know, locked into those three pillars that you built, John.
It's the operational efficiency and the operational day-to-day stuff.
Yep.
I only bring it up to, rather than wave my hands in public here and try to describe with people, it's not really, I think we're past it now, Bob.
Yeah, I found two of the three documents I need. And just to one of Marcy's points at least, under the first goal, Part C, that would certainly address the marketing piece, if you will. And it's not adequately described in an outline, but that communications position possibly being shared with the school department just to do exactly what you said.
But what I mean more specifically though is to really take an active role in marketing. So
right.
this is sort of a watered down, like we're going to consider sharing a communications position. And I think it really is important to just state that we're going to actively market the town.
Right, yeah.
It's the way that we'll.
It's outreach.
It's outreach and just helping, and it's to both residents and businesses, and
yeah.
it's just to make sure people know. We're doing a really good job here in Reading. You know
it's
what I mean?
Classic outbound marketing with so. Message and medium.
And the first step of that is to decide how you do it. So
right.
Do you
yeah,
hire a staff person? Do you hire a consultant? Do you do
that's
it
the
but
focus
that's
means.
The how you do it
that's
as
right.
opposed
that's
to
the means,
what.
That's the means, correct.
Right.
And then there's
yeah.
objectives and milestones
right.
to measure.
Right. That's
mm-hmm.
the
other. So I what I settled on by doing nothing was to ask the board to approve these goals and then understand full well we probably want to reformat it into the way that John arranged it, because I did quite like that, but
yeah,
I was missing that
good.
Piece, I guess, of tactical.
I just think some of the things that you have here support the strategic plan, but they aren't necessarily identified as part of the strategic plan.
They support it. They're underneath as a
yeah,
deliverable.
They just, I mean,
yeah, you want to have a strong organization which can then do the
right.
strategic plan.
I'd be willing, and I'd feel free to say this to consider or counter it. I'd be willing to take a pass at trying to fit the goals that are here tonight into that larger framework. And if anyone else would like to participate, I'll buy coffee or something stronger if you'd like.
Depends on the time.
I'm also happy to work with you, John.
All right. If we could, you know. All right. So I'll set up a time with Bob and anyone else who's interested.
One
probably.
Other. Yeah.
Great. One other individual.
But I would ask you to vote these goals just so we have a start.
So we have a starting point. Yep.
You can always amend them in a different format, add, subtract,
sure.
that's fine.
Yep. Move to approve the fiscal 2015 goals for the town manager as presented this evening.
Second.
John will second. Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. Okay.
Marcy, if you want to pass those in,
yeah.
I don't think anybody can read them the way they are right now. See if I can.
Feel free to do what you need
John
to do.
John and I have also promised to add some competency measures, you know, management competency criteria, you know, how well is the job being executed,
right.
that kind of thing. We still owe you that.
Okay. The town manager evaluation. So John and Dan have both prepared from the earlier discussion, the format for the town manager review. Dan, you want to?
Sure. I decided to propose four levels of ratings, and feel free, board, to jump all over this, change it around. Lowest measure B did not meet goal, meaning not even minimal progress. Two would be what we consider qualitatively an acceptable degree of progress toward meeting the goal. Three clearly met the goal, and I would expect most metrics would come out at this level. And four would be if there's clear evidence that the goal is not only met but exceeded, then the four would be appropriate. Comments for each rating as appropriate. There's a column for each selectman in that spreadsheet I sent, but and we can tally. I guess we would be the ones to tally the answers.
I guess. I thought we had talked, I'm sorry, I'm jumping into my own conversation. I thought we talked earlier about there being, maybe I'm misremembering.
There were three originally.
Three.
Yeah.
Does not meet, meets, and exceeds. And maybe the fourth is does not apply. And maybe in some cases that's an appropriate thing.
Did we have any of those? I don't remember the do not, does not apply.
It sounds like there may be a case where, in a particular case, that it wasn't achieved because there was something more pressing.
You mean like an incomplete? Or?
It's almost like an incomplete or a pending.
Right. There are times where you, and there are so many goals here that, quite frankly,
yeah,
they can't all possibly
no,
be done, and there'll be new things that come
right
up. So,
right.
Do you want to substitute the incomplete for the one, maybe?
I think that's the thought. It's
maybe that would be a better way to go.
I've never found more clicks on the volume dial to be helpful. I mean, it doesn't have to go to 11.
It's usually three or four.
Yeah. Yeah. Does not, does, and
you
exceeds.
You just have an NA written
well,
in there
yes,
as well.
If you change number one the way you just
incomplete
described.
Incomplete. Then you got three.
Yeah.
What it also does is you can articulate in your comments what you mean by that.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It didn't get done, or you stunk at it.
But, so would you entertain a thought, would you and John entertain a thought of narrowing that to the three?
I thought we just did.
Okay.
Incomplete is one.
Yeah.
And then the other three are okay. Real metrics. Mm-hmm. Made progress, well, do you want to say did not meet goal instead of acceptable progress?
I think it's NA.
Yep.
Does not meet, meets.
Okay.
And exceeds.
So you're really taking two out and replacing it with an incomplete.
Well, I think one.
That's really what you just said.
Yeah. And what that really does is force the discussion. And by the way, even if you meet, there can be opportunities to improve or selective areas where there's shortfall. And the value's in the comments. It's not in the number.
Exactly.
I think it was hard.
Sure. I mean, you can
goals
meet a
out
goal,
out
but
of
that still point doesn't satisfy
yeah
the commit.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Good luck.
Which is actually
one of my
be an interesting thing to have.
The value in all these is always the conversation. It's yep, it's the rest of it is kind of formulaic.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
In terms of the mechanics, John and I can certainly compile the results if everyone wants to send me their spreadsheet.
Yeah. So I guess the action for the board members is to complete this. Mm-hmm. And forward it to Dan.
All right, Dan, you have this. I can alter this. So what are the?
There's actually hidden columns, one for each selectman. If you, it's got your name in it, but you can just feel free to rename
the
one that's there.
Yeah, you're not going to resend this, right?
One is NA.
You already have it in electronic form.
No, that's what I'm
rating.
I'm just trying to qualify what
incomplete
the rating.
Okay. One is NA.
Yep.
Two is does not.
Did not meet.
Okay.
Three is met goal.
Four is exceeded.
Got it. Now, Bob, has it been conventional, given that I haven't done this in quite a while, for there to be a meeting with you and the two subcommittee people initially?
It's up to you. I don't feel it's necessary.
Okay.
I'm perfectly fine to be surprised on live TV.
Oh, baby.
Careful what you ask for.
It's entirely up to you.
Okay. I think we can skip that.
I would, just for the record, especially appreciate your feedback on things that weren't complete.
Right.
And what your thoughts are.
Yeah, I would expect most of the comments would be on the ones and the fours.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe the twos.
I think the comments are really important.
Yep.
I think
I
that's
agree
where the conversation comes
yeah
from.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And the time frame would be between now and our next meeting?
Yeah, mm-hmm. We did it in the next...
not next Monday.
Not
well,
Monday.
No.
Oh, no, I mean...
I was going to say, not the next meeting.
Regular
next regular scheduled meeting.
Yes.
Thank
October
you.
October
14th.
Is it that far?
A little ways
up. Yeah,
that's for the town or not town meeting.
Okay.
As of September town meeting.
Right.
Okay.
Okay, good.
Very good.
Why don't we move on? We have Approval of minutes from September 2nd. Paul, you already have mine edits in. Thank you for doing that ahead of time.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of September 2nd, 2014 as amended.
Do I have a second? John Halsey seconds. Discussion.
I have two small edits. I don't have the minutes in front of me.
Yeah.
Thank you. Bottom of page 5. It's the third paragraph up.
What do you need?
I'm not actually seeing it here.
Want us to get started with those?
Do we have 2 minutes to approve? No,
Oh, it's actually in the last sentence before the underlined. If the machine gives a report, Mr. Patel said it does. Give the date and time.
You're missing the word said between.
The word said.
Between Patel.
And page 6.
You would be the fourth.
There's a missing B. Something that should say broader says rotor, and I don't know where that is. Okay, so in the second paragraph up about the middle, mm-hmm. Finance Committee, a broader insight.
Oh, okay.
That's it.
Any other edits, changes? All those in favor of the minutes as amended, raise your hand. 5-0. That's it. With that, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
Okay.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning at 10:27, raise your hand. 5-0. Thank you very much. Good night.
Signing party.
Signing party is on the way, Harry. Don't go away.
You got it down there?
Paul, I'll gather that up.
Okay. Good.